the tradition, the pomp and circumstance, and the rivalry. It's an atmosphere unlike any other in college football. One team hails from the Rocket City, the other from the Capital City. And for the 70th time, they meet in the Magic City. We welcome you to ESPNU's College Football Primetime, presented by McDonald's. A rivalry that goes all the way back to 1924. Alabama A&M squares off with Alabama State. It's the 70th annual Magic City Classic. Hi again, everybody, alongside former NFL quarterback Jay Walker, Adam Amin on hand. Jay, you've been a part of this atmosphere for so many different years. Tell me what this atmosphere, what this event, what this game means to these two teams today.
I mean, this atmosphere is like no other, and it's grown tremendously year after year. It's always been probably the best festive atmosphere in college football, but the game takes on added significance this year because they're rivals, and Alabama State is the number one team in black college football, and Alabama A&M is the number six ranked team in black college football with an opportunity with the SWAC championship on the line. They're excited. It doesn't get any better than this.
Let's take a look at those SWAC standings. As Jay was referring to, the SWAC East Division very tight. Jackson State is not eligible to go to the SWAC championship game, so Alabama State with a win today will clinch a berth in the December 10th game back here at Legion Field in the SWAC title game. Alabama A&M can hold its own destiny in its hands with a victory over its rival today.
And the reason why this is probably the most anticipated Magic City Classic is because both teams are coming in here playing their best football. Both teams have won five consecutive games. The rivalry's on the line, bragging rights for the whole year. It's got everything you want for college football.
And Anthony Jones has done very well at the Magic City Classic, 7-2 lifetime in his 10th season as the head coach. Meanwhile, Reggie Barlow in his fifth season as the head man at Alabama State. Both teams riding five-game win streaks coming into action today. And this is a rivalry that goes back all the way to 1924. They've been playing this ball game since 1940. And since the mid-1940s, it's been right here at Legion Field. Last season, Alabama State with a victory over Alabama A&M to snap a five-game losing streak. A&M won the toss. They deferred. And Alabama State getting set to receive to start off the day. Keewon Riley, one of the speedsters on the Alabama State defense and on its special teams, ready to return. And away we go. For the 70th time, we play in Birmingham, Alabama in the Magic City Classic. John Andrews for a yard in his own end zone. A good return out to the 24-yard line. Good stick for Alabama A&M by Vandrick Jackson on special teams. And Alabama State will take over the football to start the day today.
Not a surprise that Alabama A&M won the toss, decided to defer. They believe they earned their victories by their defense, led by defensive coordinator Bronski Towns. And they want to see early on how Alabama State plans on defending against this high-pressure, high-blitz defense.
And you saw Greg Jenkins, a very good running quarterback, has Tim Clark in the backfield. He's earned a start today as well. Clark dancing, and he works his way straight up the middle for a five-yard pickup. Alabama State's offense, third in the SWAC in scoring. As you mentioned, Clark gets the start. Nick Andrews is going to be somebody you're going to want to keep your eyes on. One of the great wide receivers in Alabama State history. That offensive line has struggled at times this season. They've allowed the most sacks in the SWAC this year. Movement before the snap. As Landon Jones, one of the wide receivers, called for the false start, and negates that five-yard pickup for Clark.
And Alabama State having such a tremendous year, and much of that success goes to the transfer quarterback, Greg Jenkins, who transferred from Troy to Alabama State, bringing an added dimension to their arsenal.
Quickly wrapped up and brought down is Clark. Great pursuit for the A&M defense. Melvin Payne wrapping him up to bring him down for a loss of seven. And this Alabama A&M defense, two very good defenses squaring off today. Alabama A&M allowing just 18 points a game. That's seventh in FCS football. They run a 4-2-5 set, so two linebackers in the middle. And Vernon Marshall can play a kind of a hybrid position. He'll jump in and out between the secondary and the middle of the field. Brings up a third and 18. For the 5-yard pickup, then the penalty, and then the loss. Jenkins, screen for Landon Jones. He won't even get back to the original line of scrimmage, and Alabama A&M will force an Alabama State punt to start the day, and Jay said it. They try to win their games with their defense. They're going to try to get the offense off the field as often as possible, as quickly as possible. Bobby Wenzig, very good punter. Gets set to launch this one to Montarius Smith. Wenzig had three punts in Alabama State's last game above 50 yards. Smith will have to play it at the 30 on a bounce. Nowhere to go. Great coverage by Jazrick Peterson. He has been the special teams stud this year for Alabama State. Alabama A&M takes over after a 49-yard punt and a 2-yard return. And you get a look at Deontay Mason, the transfer from Kentucky, getting set to take over this offense for the Bulldogs.
And Mason's a guy that truly is the key player for this Alabama A&M offense. You hear that all the time throughout the country. You need great quarterback play. Well, if he does not play well, they do not win.
He was injured in last year's Magic City Classic, suffered a groin injury, and then ended up missing 5 games last season because of that injury. He had a very good Magic City Classic in 09. Handoff goes to Kadarius Lacy, a big hole up the middle. <laughs> 44 yards to start the day for Kadarius Lacy.
Big run like from the running back when an I formation means you got to follow the fullback, number 42, Brian Nelson, right here behind the quarterback. You're going to see him find the gap right here, and it becomes a foot race. See the fullback seal the corner, then it becomes a foot race, and Lacy showing you good speed. Big play for the Bulldogs in their first possession.
Lacy, third in the SWAC in rushing, averages 77 a game. He picked up 44 on that first carry. His second carry will set up a very solid second and 5. There's the Alabama A&M offense with Lacy in the backfield. He is the key along with Mason. Both are very good runners. Bryant Ross gets the start at the left guard today for a front line that has been very solid. They've only allowed 12 sacks all season, and already the Bulldogs inside of the red zone.
Alabama A&M playing smash mouth football early, gaining control of the line of scrimmage. The Hornets are going to have to counter.
Alabama A&M just 65% in the red zone this season in scoring. Mason taking it to the left, cuts it inside the 10-yard line. A first down run and a first and goal set up for Alabama A&M against this Alabama State defense, coming in fourth in the country in scoring defense this season. They're averaging, allowing just 16 points per ball game, but an early threat for Alabama A&M. Leland Baker is an interesting story. He was originally slated to be suspended for the first half of this game, but he is allowed to play the entire game today. And Keewon Riley and Saeed Lee, two guys that are top 5 in the country in interceptions. Alabama State leads the nation in both turnover margin and takeaways. But it's the Bulldogs threatening early in this game. First and goal. Mason will get a couple of yards. It's wrapped up and brought down by Draquay Everett. And Deontay Mason, very solid for this team, doing a lot of different things. Not passing at a very accurate clip, but he can give some good quick passes. He can run the football, and this is what Alabama State is doing defensively in the red zone, brought to you by Verizon.
When you talk about Mason, it's the ability to run the football. He's not the guy that makes this offense go with his arm per se. It's the ability to run the football when the passing lanes are not there.
Lacy inside of the 5-yard line. Raymond Henningberg got to him first. Third and goal after a gain of 1. And they'll set up about 3.5 yards out. Alabama A&M's red zone offense, again, just 7th in the SWAC this season. Both teams are outstanding defensively, and that carries over into the red zone for these defenses. I think an early score is going to be huge for either one of these teams.
Yeah, when you look at that statistic there, it tells you that Alabama A&M has been able to overcome their own self-inflicted wound, 65% in the red zones. Normally not good enough to win a championship, but the defense has been superb.
Lacy won't get to the end zone. He'll be a couple of yards short. A three-yard pickup, fourth and goal, and maybe early decision time for Anthony Jones of the Bulldogs, and it looks like the field goal unit will come on the field.
A little surprising considering you've got the ball. This is a game you're going out trying to get yourself a championship. You get it that close down there, you've got a defense that you believe in. If you don't score, then force them to go 98, 99 yards on you. But in this case here, I guess Coach Jones feels that points are going to come at a premium, and you got to take all the points you can get.
Just three field goal attempts in the last five games for Chance Wilson. He bangs home a 19-yard chip shot, and he puts the Bulldogs on the board first. The 70th annual Magic City Classic here from Birmingham, Alabama. ESPNU College Football Primetime is presented to you by McDonald's. I'm loving it.
Provocative. Unexpected.
The 70th annual Magic City Classic. Alabama A&M with a seven-play drive over 3.5 minutes to put up 3 points. Let's take a look at what's on tap today. Gotta love the atmosphere here at Legion Field in the Magic City Classic. Alabama State next season getting set in 441 days on that countdown to open up a new stadium. And you're gonna love this, Jay Walker. It's been tough standing next to him because he's kind of wobbly after eating all that food out of the tailgate.
I came in today's contest probably weighing about a buck 50. Now I'm probably weighing about a buck 55.
Right. If you're a buck 50,
you're a couple ounces.
Keewon Riley, after Alabama State offensively got the ball first and was forced to punt, the Bulldogs come back with a field goal. John Andrews had a decent return his last time. He'll take it from the three. Looking for a seam. He won't get to the 25-yard line. A 22-yard return.
In a game like this, you can just tell the intensity level by the play on special teams. Every time there's been a kickoff or a punt, there's been a hard collision made down the field. That lets you know how amped and pumped up these young men are to play in today's football game.
That's Vandrick Jackson again. That's his second special teams tackle today. So with 9:14 to go, Alabama State and Greg Jenkins, the transfer from Troy, take over at their own 24.5-yard line. Tim Clark in the backfield. And a four-receiver set for Jenkins.
And by them going with that four-receiver set makes it very difficult for Alabama A&M to try and disguise their blitzes like they like to do. Fred Kice having his team set up in this formation, then calling the play after.
Fred Kice, the first-year offensive coordinator for Alabama State. Jenkins pumps and gets brought down. Corey Hart has made things difficult for just about everybody this year. He was pointing out for the football. Jenkins may have coughed it up after a loss of two. But Corey Hart has been outstanding on the line.
Yeah, I mean, Corey Hart is going to come from right here and just one-on-one beat his man. This is what you want. You're going to see him explode. Pardon me. He came from the other side there and beat this guy there. Apologies. But you saw the one-on-one beat. He's a real good football player.
Bobbled, intercepted. The Bulldogs force a turnover. Clarence Morris, the senior from Prattville, Alabama, with his first pick of the year, and the Bulldogs have it.
Alabama A&M kind of beating Alabama State with a dose of their own medicine. State is a team that normally leads the country in takeaways. But you see the tip ball here, it hangs in the air on the deflection. Good concentration to bring that ball in for the interception by Clarence Morris.
And Luther Snipe, the freshman from Tuskegee, knocked it away from T.C. McWilliams. And Morris comes away with it. And very good field position for Anthony Jones and the Bulldogs. Lacy stacked up by Slater. Push the pile for a 5-yard pickup. Boy, Kadarius Lacy had that nice 44-yard run on the first drive, the first play from scrimmage for the Bulldogs, and that set up their solid scoring drive.
And they really need to try and capitalize and not settle for a field goal attempt right now. They've got to try and score a touchdown.
And again, Alabama State, this is what they've done better than anybody in the country this year.
Yeah, they're number one in all levels of college football at this, at a plus 18 margin for takeaways. What does that mean? It means that they normally don't give it away, but they take it away.
That's just the 8th giveaway this season for Alabama State's offense, as Lacy probably ended up losing about a yard and a half on that play. Lacy, the junior from Calera, Alabama. Anthony Jones says he reminds me of Franco Harris a little bit. Not a speed back, but a big bruiser that can break open a hole and take it deep.
Franco's one of those guys that is, the years have gone by, kind of underestimated. The fact that he had the ability to catch the ball and run like a wide receiver when needed in pass routes.
Halfway home in the first. David Isabel, who's also the backup quarterback for Mason, has checked in as a running back. They also use him as a receiver. He's on the far side going out for the screen. There's Isabel. And a good open field tackle as the ball comes loose. DeMarcus Taylor came over and jarred the ball. Ball went out of bounds, so it stays with A&M. But David Isabel, a junior from Huntsville, he's a transfer from UAB. Nearly coughed it up and gave it back.
They go with the swing pass, and good job of conversion on the football once it leaves the quarterback's hands. And good tackle coming from the inside there by Denzel Cotton, forcing that ball loose. Fortunately for Alabama A&M, the ball went out of bounds. What a great job by the Alabama State defense. That's a moral victory for them. Your offense has a turnover, and you hold the opposing team with 3 plays and out. Good job by the Hornets.
Longest attempt for the season for Chance Wilson, and instead he will pooch punt this one away. And nearly got it into deep inside of the 5. And instead it's sent out of bounds, and it'll be a 20-yard line field position to start. Alabama State takes over, and when we come back, Jay Walker will take you around the tailgate area.
All right, amongst the people, when we come back, I'll show you where you can get some real good eating here at the Magic City Classic.
I've always loved the taste of chocolate. Caramel is the sweet treat I crave. Chocolate, so
amongst the sea of people, it's your boy, Jay Walker, here at the 70th annual Magic City Classic. Plenty of people out here in the parking lot. This was my breakfast. Now it's time for me to find lunch, dinner, and then some. Let's see what I can discover here at the Magic City Classic. What do y'all have over here?
Gumbo.
Gumbo? Oh, I'm going to get some gumbo. It looks delicious. Hey, look, now we're talking. Now we're talking. Huh?
It melts in your mouth, not in your hand.
I'm going to be the judge of that,
okay,
all right?
All right.
I'm
going to
be the judge of that.
It melts in your mouth, not in your hand. Watch it. Watch it.
Mm. What did you put up in here?
Jay's loving life right about now. It's a 3-0 Alabama A&M lead. A new quarterback is into the ballgame for Alabama State, as Quindarius McKibben gets his first carry of the day and takes it for a yard. McKibben, usually the starting running back. Devin Dominguez is into the game as the quarterback. How are you feeling right now, Jay?
I'm full.
Heartburn or anything like that?
I'm full. There's more to come. Don't go anywhere. We've got much more to come.
Devin Dominguez, who was the starter last season for Alabama State, playing in his 4th game this year. He has started a game as well. Back to throw, pocket collapsing. He'll throw the ball down. The ball is loose. It's a live ball, and the Bulldogs have forced their 2nd turnover of the day. Melvin Payne comes away with it. A terrible decision by Dominguez, and the Bulldogs have great field position again.
Dominguez coming to this game, they thought it would be a strength that he played in this game last year. He wouldn't be rattled. But this looks like a freshman mistake, not one from a senior quarterback. Once he's in the grasp, just touch that football. He's trying to actually get rid of it, didn't secure it. Big turnover for the Bulldogs.
Corey Hart brought the heat, and Anthony Jones's team is winning the turnover battle against a team that leads the country in turnover margin coming into action today.
Last time they got the turnover, they didn't capitalize.
Right.
It's only a 3-0 lead, and Alabama A&M has had tremendous opportunities. I think it's crucial that they walk away with the touchdown on this drive.
Third time in the red zone already today. A reverse. Mason is out there blocking for Terrence Pride. Pride into the end zone.
17-yard scamper around the right side for Moldova.
First time that the redshirt freshman from Harvest, Alabama has carried the ball this season, and he punches it in for a touchdown. Yard touchdown run. Chance Wilson makes it a 10-0 Bulldog lead. You want to talk about capitalizing? There you go.
Took advantage of it. A little razzle-dazzle here at the Magic City Classic. Alabama A&M holding on to a 10-0 lead.
From the beginning, the Southwestern Athletic Conference has molded and formed students to become legends, to step into the world and take it by storm. The Southwestern Athletic Conference prides itself in excellence, in determination, and grit, and in making champions. There are some here, some that the next generation will call heroes. The Southwestern Athletic Conference honor the heritage.
ESPNU comes.
Keewon Riley from a yard deep in his own end zone with a solid return out past the 30-yard line for Alabama State. The Hornets are in a hole right now after a little bit of trickery from the Bulldogs.
Well, they ran the misdirection. It was a great job by the left tackle, Jamal Johnson-Webb, to get up to the second level. See, the misdirection is going to take you here, but watch Webb come and seal this side here, allowing the running lane for the touchdown run to take place there. Good job by the left tackle getting all the way to the right side of the line with the misdirection to seal the edge and the perimeter.
Terrence Pride, his first rushing touchdown of the season. It was set up after Devin Dominguez, as the backup quarterback, came in on the last touch and fumbled the football after a play fair to a fire. Nick Andrews has his first catch of the day, taken down by Rico Porch. Andrews, the all-time Alabama State leader in touchdowns, in receptions, and he's closing in on his head coach, Reggie Barlow. Yeah, in yardage.
He's a real good one, the all-time greats in the SWAC conference. And
flag is thrown, but Nick Andrews has made back-to-back catches, this time 26-yard pickup. And that hurry-up offense for Alabama State trying to catch the Bulldogs napping, but a flag was thrown before the snap.
Penalties decline. Results on the play. First down.
Is that what you want to see, I imagine, from a no-huddle offense there?
Yeah, catch him slipping. They're trying to get that substitution in there. Good job by Dominguez getting the ball snapped and throwing a good pass to Nick Andrews.
Devin Dominguez, and just the fourth game he's playing in this season. He's a solid starter last year. He can do some things with your feet, but he's not as athletic as Greg Jenkins is. Under 5 minutes to go in this first quarter. This is the deepest Alabama State has been offensively today. Inside the 30. The Bulldogs continue to bring the heat. And guess who? Corey Hart with another sack. It's his ninth of the season. Four-yard loss.
Right now, Alabama State has a problem because you've got Corey Hart that continues to win his one-on-one matchup time and time again, getting a big wide start from the outside, has the ability just to come underneath once Dominguez tries to leave the pocket.
The defensive coordinator Bronski Towns talked about it. He wanted Corey Hart to slide out a little bit. They needed to contain the running game of the quarterbacks, Jenkins and now Dominguez. Here's McKibben. And he will not get back to the original line of scrimmage. He'll only get 1 yard on that play.
Going back to Devin Dominguez, this is the kid that came to Alabama State as a baseball player first, was a very good baseball player, had a good baseball career there, thrown in the action last season. Greg Jenkins had been battling a sore shoulder, and I think maybe in that first series when he got sacked by Corey Hart, in that first series he might have bruised it. So during the bye week, Dominguez took 75% of the reps. So they kind of anticipated that Jenkins may get hurt and they may be forced to put Dominguez in action.
Hit as he throws on 3rd and 13, fourth down for Alabama State. How about Corey Hart again? Boy, Dominguez and Jenkins have been on the ground a lot because of that man today.
He's all over the field, and Alabama A&M is known for having a very quick and active defensive line, and Corey Hart fits that mold. This is the school that produced Robert Mathis, Pro Bowl defensive end for the Indianapolis Colts, and Corey Hart plays that same speed rush position that Robert Mathis played when he was here at Alabama A&M.
Wenzig has been solid this year, 48-yarder coming. And he missed it wide to the left. One of the top kickers in the SWAC, unable to convert, and Alabama State empty again. This Monday on a special Halloween edition of the Palmer and Pollock Show, find out what tricks the boys have up their sleeves to break down the number one LSU versus number two Alabama showdown. College football lives here every day on ESPNU. So you got David Pollock is Dracula, some kind of vampire, and I guess Jesse Palmer is a Frankenstein. I hope they pick those out. Speaking of good defensive ends like David Pollock was, how about Corey Hart today? Third in the conference in sacks. He's already got another one today. He's really brought pressure all day, and he's given Alabama State's offense opportunities. Mason keeps it. Stacked up right near the line of scrimmage, no gain.
When you get this type of environment, you know, you want your big-time players to make big-time plays, and Corey Hart seems to be rising to the occasion for the Bulldogs. Alabama State needs to come up with a solution, and I'm pretty sure they'll be discussing that on the sidelines. How do we block him? Do we have to get an extra blocker to help keep him out of our backfield?
Jay told you about the atmosphere. The first year they had this game, there were 2,000 people. Now this place is about 70,000 stacked just about every year, and there's plenty more in the parking lots outside. Second and 11. Lacey will get the handoff. Dives for a gain of three. Raymond Henningberg tripped him up, and third down coming for Alabama A&M. As you get a look at Leland Baker. And Baker, who's been a great linebacker for them, against Prairie View A&M back in October the 15th, he had an issue after a play. A flagrant foul was called against him. He wasn't flagged on the play, but it was seen on video. Baker was originally going to be suspended for the first half of today's game. Alabama State appealed it, so he is allowed to play the entire game today. Likely he will have to sit out for a half at some point, or maybe even a full game, but he's here for the Magic City Classic. He's in on a third and eight as Mason rolls to the right and connects. A first down catch made by Gialonzo Milton, the junior from Miami, converts with an 11-yard catch. And this is what Anthony Jones was saying earlier about the Baker suspension.
Yeah, and I think this is a quality statement from a quality individual, Anthony Jones. You know, they don't worry about that. They're going to support the conference's decision. Those are the rules in place for the appeal process in the SWAC conference. And ultimately, he said, if we're going to go out and beat Alabama State, we want to have our best players going against their best players. He's got no problem with it. He thinks his team could get it done on the field.
And you talk about a class individual, absolutely, in his 10th season as the head coach of Alabama A&M. Mason, delayed handoff to Lacey. And a flag is thrown late at the end of the play. 2-yard pickup for Lacey. DeMarcus Taylor came in for the stop, and this might be a face mask penalty against the Alabama State linebacker. These are two of the less penalized teams in the SWAC this year.
Pulling the face mask. Defense, number 34. 15-yard penalty will be added to the end of the run. First down.
Take a look, y'all. He's got it there. Actually, two. One of the defenders tackling high around that face mask there. Easy call.
Yeah, they got Wyndon Stewart for the other one, who's back after missing a couple of games. So Alabama A&M gets to move the football inside of the Alabama State 40-yard line. 10-0 lead with 90 seconds to go. And Smith had one go. That one go right through his hands. So second down. Terrius Smith, the team leader in receptions this year, just a redshirt freshman from right here in Birmingham.
So getting to play in front of the hometown folks, always a great thrill. Having that opportunity and just playing in this environment by itself. I mean, can you imagine? I was talking to some of the players down on the field, some of the coaches, and they were just so excited. They wish they could play. You know, as a former player, I wish I could play in this type of atmosphere right now. It's kind of get your juices going.
Reggie Barlow was undefeated as a player. when he played in the Magic City Classic. Played in the mid-90s, early mid-90s for Alabama State, great wide receiver. Lacy on second and 10. Will work up the middle for a gain of 2 yards before Carlton Jones grabs him and brings him down. Barlow turned into a very solid NFL receiver, has a Super Bowl with the Tampa Bay Bucks. Both coaches have Super Bowl rings.
And Reggie Barlow is a guy that his star is so bright right now, considering the job he's done at Alabama State. They played in the SWAC championship game last season, didn't win. This year, the number one team in black college football. Great record, great character, great demeanor about himself. And you can tell when you talk to him, he just gets it. He understands the overall big picture. He's a coach that's on the rise, and he's going places. Hopefully no time soon if you're a Hornet fan.
Lost to Texas Southern in the SWAC title game last season. Mason, that's a screen for Isabel. Trying to find room to run. He won't get the first down. It'll be a couple of yards short. And with 20 seconds to go in the first, let's see if that winds us all the way down. And Alabama A&M will gladly take a 10-0 lead into the second.
And you can see what their offensive game plan is going to be. They know that Alabama State, they're Hornets. They swarm. That's what Hornets do. So what are they doing? A lot of misdirection, sending everything to the left and coming back to the right, not letting Alabama State know how they plan on attacking.
So fourth and two for Alabama A&M after one quarter play. They'll open up the second quarter with the football and a decision to make. The long run from Lacy, the defense of Alabama A&M, and a 10-0 Bulldog lead.
Missouri versus Missouri Southern tips off tomorrow at 6:30 on ESPNU.
Dad, a big giant bee, get it!
Hang on, pumpkin. Oh, bad call, Dad. Hey, sweetie, guess what? The bees came back and I broke the
you.
A 10-0 Bulldog lead as we get set to start the second quarter for the Magic City Classic in Birmingham, Alabama. One of the great Alabama State Hornets of all time, Tamaris Jackson. Third in school history, nearly 5,000 passing yards in his time as an Alabama State Hornet. And Tamaris Jackson is kind enough to join us on the phone right now. Tamaris, how are you doing today?
I'm doing good. How you doing?
Doing very well. Really appreciate you taking the time with us. First things first, I mean, it's got to be fun to be able to get some memories back in the Magic City Classic. What was your favorite Magic City Classic memory when you were a Hornet?
I can't hear the last part. Say it again.
What was your favorite memory as a Hornet when you were in the Magic City Classic?
Man, I honestly, all I heard was Magic City Classic.
You got a favorite memory, perhaps?
Yes, man, I got a couple memories, but you know, the ones that really stick out is the one when you win. I enjoyed all of them. You know, there was some good times, great experience. You know, I advise anyone that goes to a college try to experience it once. You know, especially in Alabama, it's a great experience. So kind of missed those times, man. It was some good times.
Tavares, you obviously, you're very busy in the NFL schedule. How proud are you of this Hornet program now that they're the number one team in all of black college football?
I'm very proud of those guys, man. It's been a down couple years for us, and you know, Coach Barlow has been trying to get the right guys in, get his right personnel in, and now he got him some guys, got him a quarterback, and you know, those guys are playing good football right now. I'm very proud of them.
Well, Tavares, thanks for taking the time. Seattle Seahawks quarterback now, second-round pick out of Alabama State by the Vikings, and they get set to take on the Bengals in the next week, taking on the Dallas Cowboys. Tavares, thanks so much for your time. Really appreciate it.
All right, no problem.
Great to hear from a great Hornet, and Reggie Barlow has his picture up on the wall next to Tavares Jackson's picture in Alabama State's football offices.
I got an opportunity to watch him play here, and he was a special talent. No surprise that he would have success in the NFL.
Kadarius Lacy getting the brunt of the carries on this drive. A 5-yard pickup on 2nd and 7. The Bulldogs converted a 4th down to start the quarter. They've got a 10-0 lead a minute into this second quarter. And you got to look at what Tavares Jackson did while he was at Alabama State.
You know, when you see those numbers there, one thing about Tavares Jackson, which people don't realize, he was a transfer to Alabama State. He was originally at the University of Arkansas, and then he had to compete and share time with Matt Jones, so he ended up coming to Alabama State, which turned out to be a good move for him because Alabama State's in his hometown of Montgomery. And when he got there, he really took that offense to a new level and really dominated SWAC play, which is what you have to do at this level, and was rewarded by being a second-round draft pick to the NFL.
All right, now the starting quarterback for the Seattle Seahawks, taking over as a full-time starter for the first time. DeMarcus Taylor, after that play, taking down Kadarius Lacy. Taylor very slow to get up. Good sign to see at least plenty of movement from DeMarcus Taylor, who had a great game against Texas Southern a couple of weeks ago, a second team SWAC selection from Jacksonville.
You know, one thing about this game that you've got to realize is Alabama A&M has only been playing, they've only been playing FCS level football for 15 years. They were a Division II program, so for them they were always a little small sister compared to Alabama State, but they've earned their respect by winning a couple Magic City Classics.
We'll step aside here as DeMarcus Taylor is helped off the field. The 70th annual Magic City Classic. We're in Birmingham, Alabama. Some of the pageantry.
Hey, good morning.
You see plenty of celebrities that have made their way to Birmingham, Alabama as well. A great atmosphere. And right here in the heart of Alabama, Birmingham.
So far, celebrity-wise, I've seen Rupert Studdard sing the national anthem, right. Tom Joyner, Lisa Ray, and more to come, I believe.
Steve Harvey's announced today as well. 11th play of this drive for Alabama A&M. A rough handoff to Lacy, trying to pick up the 2 yards he needed for the first down. We'll see if he has enough based on forward progress.
Yeah, not a smooth handoff there. You see he was juggling it the whole time. Never really had control to the end of the run. And I think that inhibited him from picking up the first down.
And it is a fourth down, and they'll try to convert their second fourth down of this drive. They use Mason hopping forward like he should have enough for it. They're going to bring the chain gang out.
I think that was one of those cases where Coach Jones said, we should be up by more than we are. You know, it's only a 10-point lead. We should have more points on the board. Opportunity, fourth and one, try and put this more points on the board. They want another touchdown. But they've clearly been dominating in the first quarter, but they only have a 10-point lead. If they can score a touchdown now, that'll give them a 3-score lead.
And it's been takeaways for the Bulldogs that have helped set up some good field position for them. Already 2 takeaways against an Alabama State team that had only given it away 7 times all year. Alabama A&M will use a timeout with 12:45 to go here in this second quarter. ESPNU is the home for passionate college football fans as our experts break down the top schools in the nation in a weekly 3-hour special. Don't miss any of the unfiltered conversation about the hot topics in college football. The experts at ESPNU Tuesdays at 1 and 7 Eastern. This is who will be joining Anish Schroff this week. And Matt Millen joining this week's panel. Charles Arbuckle will join as well. Plenty coming up on ESPNU as well as next week's schedule. Big Big East games. Syracuse, remember that big win over West Virginia last week. Ole Miss in Kentucky, Cincy in Pittsburgh. And then a whack battle, Louisiana Tech out in California to take on the Fresno State Bulldogs. All on ESPNU next Saturday. We talk about taking advantage of opportunities. Alabama A&M has had the turnovers. They've gone for it on fourth down and converted twice on this drive, and this might stem back all the way to drive number one when they forced a punt from Alabama State, had good field position, got a good run, were set up for a touchdown, were inside the 5 and ended up going with a field goal. You thought maybe they should have gone maybe for the jugular a little earlier, and maybe this is why they've gone for it on fourth down.
Yeah, they had the ball on the 1.5-yard line. I think you take that chance right there early in the contest, but now the sense of urgency, and I think they may go for it all the way through on this drive.
But Lacy breaks that first tackle. Lacy, touchdown, 17 yards.
Lacy, 17 yards.
said he's got a hard running style there, and watch him meet Brandon Slater in the hole there. Slater does not wrap up. That's the initial thud, but Lacy does a good job of bouncing off of the tackle, absorbing the blow, and getting in the end zone.
Now you see why maybe Anthony Jones made that comparison to Franco Harris. Big bruiser bangs it in from 17, and it's a 17-0 Bulldog lead. A half dozen touchdowns on the year for Lacy, one of the top rushers in the SWAC. He's given the Bulldogs a big advantage in quarter number two. Jay Walker brings you more from the parking lots when we come back.
My stomach tells me I should be going this way. this is a pig. That's a pig. Turkey neck, shrimp, corn, and sauce.
Right. Turkey. That's a Cajun roll.
What's up, man? What, you want to be on TV? Don't eat my microphone, man.
Standing.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you know what you're doing. I'm lighting my Magic City microphone, man. But this is a three-story barbecue pit. They don't do it no better. They don't do it no better.
Does that microphone even exist anymore?
It started off as a turkey leg, and it started to look like a chicken drumstick at the end because it was so good I had to eat it. I mean, phenomenal. When he showed us that pig, that surprised us. We didn't know what he had under. We said, just show us the food. And he said, oh, I got something special for you. Too bad for the hog.
Alabama State will start from the 40-yard line. They're going to need good field position right now. The number one team in all of black college football, down 17-0 to Anthony Jones's club. Remember, Anthony Jones, 7-2 all time in the Magic City Classic.
Kicking team, number 13. Ball will be placed at the 40-yard line. First down.
And Alabama State has struggled to move the football so far in this game. The turnovers have been the surprise for a team that leads the nation in turnover margin.
Yes, and with all the negative yardage there, is going to hurt them. They've got to get it going. And one of the things that really, you know, hurt Alabama A&M just now, that kickoff out of bounds. You've got everything going. Don't help out a team by giving them good field position.
It'll look at Greg Jenkins on the sideline, the starting quarterback, who was sacked early in this ball game, and as Jay told you, he may have been feeling it a little bit in his shoulder. But Devin Dominguez has taken over the last couple of drives. He's passed the ball well, and Nick Andrews has been his main target. A half dozen yards for Andrews, his third catch of the day, the all-time leading receiver in Alabama State history, could have an opportunity to break the yardage record at Alabama State today. Needed 108 coming in.
Yeah, definitely an impact player, probably the best offensive weapon in the SWAC conference, having a standout senior year.
Flag thrown, Dominguez takes a shot. And it'll be third down, pending the flag. May have been some early movement. Willie Fuller will give Alabama State the first down, rushing it.
Had several jerseys there they could have called it on. Good voice cadence by Devin Dominguez, and maybe now he's starting to find a little bit of rhythm and flow. Backup quarterback, normally takes him a series or two to get adjusted. You're a Hornet fan, you gotta hope he's starting to feel comfortable in the game.
Well, first and 10, inside of Alabama A&M territory. And off the 10 play. But there were 4 yards on first down as he gets dragged down by Monte Rover. Coming into this drive, Alabama A&M had outgained Alabama State by 106 yards.
Yeah, you take a look at number 95, Hart. He's normally a defensive end standing down, but they've been moving him all over the field so that the Alabama State offense cannot account for where he is on the football field.
Landon Jones, the catch at the 40. Shy of the first down marker. He got hit very hard right off the bat by A.J. Clark. 5-yard pickup for Landon Jones. Might be the top wide receiver on this team had it not been for the phenomenal season for Nick Andrews. Phenomenal career for Andrews, really. Third and one.
See, so as they break the huddle, Hart right now is lined up in the middle linebacker position almost, and they're trying to, you know, have this chess match of where is he going to line up. So you see the Hornets taking their time. Now Hart goes all the way out wide to the right. This is him right here in the stand-up position. Will he stay there when the ball snaps?
It'll be Dominguez picking up the first down. Is jumping forward to move the chains.
And Dominguez, you know, he's a big kid, 6 feet 5 inches tall, weighs about 210 pounds. He's deceptively fast. He's got good wheels. He can move. Now, he's not quite the runner that Greg Jenkins is, but he's by no means a pocket quarterback, meaning a slow runner. He can hurt you with his legs as well.
Pretty accurate, though, when he does pass the ball. It's about 60%. He's thrown the ball decently so far today. Alabama State likes explosive plays. We haven't seen any of those today so far. Good pickup of the pressure initially, but Alabama A&M gets another big play from Corey Hart, a loss of three. Corey Hart continues to make it tough on this offensive line.
I mean, we talked about where they're moving him from, so now they've got the matchup. Corey Hart against a running back in the backfield. A good defensive lineman is going to win that battle all the time. Alabama State has not made that adjustment of Corey Hart playing the stand-up linebacker position, and that's why he's had such a great impact.
Alabama State has given up the most sacks this season in the SWAC. They've given up three today. Dominguez fires. Good reach for Jones, and he dives ahead, might have enough for the first down, and it looks like he does after a pick of a 15.
Good job by Landon Jones of, as you said, reaching out and pulling the ball out of the air. By grabbing that ball, which was thrown too far to the inside, he was able to have his momentum going towards the first down marker and had just enough yardage to pick it up.
To the 25-yard line.
Look, that's Hart right there. Where's he going to go? He's lined up in the middle. Now he's probably not going to stay there. Now you see him start to go over to the right. Do they account for it?
Three down linemen. It's being shown. They'll rush seven. Hart missed. Dominguez trying to get to the edge. Can't get rid of the football. It's another sack for the Bulldogs. Vernon Marshall got to him.
You know, by them moving around Corey Hart, they can't account for him, and you're going to see the pressure. He's going to be the one that's actually going to flush Dominguez out the pocket. Misses him right there, but there were a number of Bulldog defenders there to help complete the sack. But that's the pressure, and they're just collapsing that pocket. And if a wide receiver is not open immediately, then Dominguez knows he's going to get hit.
I feel like Dominguez has to get rid of that at the end of that play, right? Second and 17. Empty backfield. Four-man rush. Ball nearly deflected at the line of scrimmage. And it gets dropped by John Andrews. And Vernon Marshall jarred it loose. Third and long for the Hornets.
Right now, the Bulldogs are winning this chess match. And Bronski Towns and staff are doing a tremendous job. You just get the feeling that the Hornet quarterback is just not seeing things well right now. And that's something that Reggie Barlow and the staff, offensive coordinator Fred Kaiser, are going to have to make some adjustments, because you can't continue to have your quarterback getting hit like this, and they're forcing you to throw the ball out of your rhythm. No timing in the passing game.
Greg Jenkins was knocked around, the starter on the sidelines. Devin Dominguez has been on the deck a handful of times already. Play clock at four. Third and 17. Dominguez flushed, pressure. Fifth sack of the day. Corey Hart does it again.
Give credit to the secondary for Alabama A&M on that sack there. On that play, Corey Hart lined up in a traditional defensive lineman stance from a three-point position. Nowhere to go. So this is Hart right here, lined up in the three-point stance. Got his eye on the quarterback, and the moment Dominguez tries to get flushed out of the pocket. Oh! Don't cut into a headache, son.
Dominguez was looking. Nobody was open. Wenzig, who missed from 48 earlier today, will try to hit from 48 to put the Hornets on the board. Pretty slice on that swing from Bobby Wenzig. The transfer from Arizona State finally gets Alabama State on the board with 7:43 to go in the Magic City Classic's first half. you to today, the 70th annual Magic City Classic. The program from today, which serves multiple purposes, and you need to use that on a gorgeous, yeah, I mean, you could not ask for a better, more picture-perfect fall day here in Birmingham for a series that began in 1940. These two teams have played since 1924. It's been played every year since 1940, except for obviously the 2 years when World War II played a factor, and the parade earlier today, they had a luncheon earlier in the week, a press conference as well, the team dinners, the pageantry, everything
they're involved. They're missing something on that graphic.
What are they missing? Though?
Tailgate.
That's right.
Food, barbecue, and more barbecue.
Terrence Pride has to bring it out of the end zone. Well, after the bobble, Pride is stuck at the 5-yard line. And Alabama State, which leads the conference in kick coverage, takes advantage of a mistake by Pride, who already has a touchdown in this game.
Yeah, the kickoff and kickoff return teams for Alabama A&M have let them down. They kicked the ball out of bounds, so when the Hornets got the ball that last possession, they started with the ball on the 40-yard line, went down to kick the field goal. Now, really putting your offense in a bind, making a poor decision to come out of the end zone. Now you've got the ball inside your own 5-yard line, and the Hornets are on the prowl. They can try and force the Bulldogs into a turnover or three and out and get the ball back with good field position again.
And they've had great field position, the Bulldogs, all day long, taking advantage of some takeaways as well. This is their worst field position of the day, as you can imagine, from the five. Kadarius Lacy, though, trying to give them some breathing room. Remember the first play from scrimmage, he had that 44-yard run, set things up, and it really set the tone. Lacy had the touchdown to make it 17-0 today.
And I wouldn't be surprised if you saw a heavy dose of Lacy on this drive here. They haven't figured him out yet, Alabama State. They're trying to bring him down up high. He's got such a small, compact frame, very powerful runner. You've got to go after him low.
Lacy may not have enough to reach the century mark there. Does pick up a yard before Brandon Slater brings him down, and a third and short situation coming for the Bulldogs.
And that's what you have to do when you've got a team trying to play powerhouse football. When they go with that I formation, you've got to bottle them up. Make the big running back change directions. Get his shoulders going sideways. Don't allow him to run downhill. Good job by the Hornets on that previous play.
Bulldogs need just 2 yards. They're 1 for 5 today. They've been solid for the most part this season. Alabama State sends the house. Lacy can't get past that first line. Great play by Donovan Maslin, the all-SWAC selection, forcing a fourth down. Big play. Hornets needed that.
And once again, they force Lacy to run sideways, which is not his strength. He's a downhill runner. North, south, not east, west. Good job by the Hornets.
So Chance Wilson gets set to punt away from his own end zone. How about that? 14 out of his 32 punts inside the 20-yard line. He's got a good directional kicker. I don't think this particular one will make it, but Keewon Riley will try to bring it back. Decent field position coming for Alabama State with 5:27 to go here in this second quarter, 38-yard punt. The college basketball season will tip off right here on ESPNU Sunday night with the One State, One Spirit Classic, the Missouri Tigers and in-state opponent Division II Missouri Southern. This exhibition game will take place in Joplin, Missouri. A moment of silence will be recognized at 5:41 Central Time, the official time that a tornado touchdown, an E5 tornado on May the 22nd. The One State, One Spirit Classic presented by Leggett and Platt, Inc. on ESPNU Sunday at 6:30 Eastern.
I actually had an opportunity to visit Joplin, did a high school football game there, and the devastation with that tornado created an impact at that community. Hard to believe, hard to recognize, and that could happen, but good to see they're not forgotten in spirit.
And Frank Haith, the Missouri Tiger head coach, brought him there back in May. Second down coming up. Devin Dominguez can't find John Andrews. The first time Missouri Southern will be hosting a basketball game on an ESPN network. Missouri grad John Anderson, our colleague, as well as Fran Fraschilla, will be on site for the game. And you talk about tornadoes and the kind of havoc they wreak. Alabama knows that all too well as well.
Missouri South, that school where Rod Smith played his college football there. NFL legend, Denver Bronco.
Second and 10 for Dominguez and the Hornets. Quick throw, Nick Andrews breaks the first tackle and has enough for first down yardage. A dozen yards for Andrews, who may have lost the football at the end of the play. And Alabama A&M has forced a third turnover.
So often we see those receivers and running backs trying to get that extra yard, that second effort, and the ball comes loose. Andrews does a good job of making the first defender miss. Doesn't secure the ball properly, and Luther Snipe does a good job of just wrestling that ball out of there at the end. Good job of yanking it. And Willie Fuller makes the recovery. Look at this. Watch this. Pull! Got it out.
Just had enough. Reggie Barlow's team, which again came into this ballgame leading the country in turnover margin, has coughed it up three different times. And the Bulldogs take over again. Mason checks down to Lacey. It'll be a loss of a couple of yards. Good pressure from the Hornet defense that time. Kinjay Cotton. With under 5 minutes to go, Alabama A&M comes up with another stop. We'll have second and 13 here.
Second down and 13 coming up for A&M.
Lacey has a touchdown today. Terrence Pride has one as well. Both rushing touchdowns from 17 yards out. Alabama and A&M has added a field goal as well. They went up 17-0. Hornets have had the ball a half dozen times. They've only put up 3 points. Play clock down to one. Quick throw to the sideline. Good effort from Montarius Smith, but really isn't going to get anything. A flag is thrown after a gain of one.
That was a well-designed wide receiver screen there. Had the receiver been able to keep his footing, there was a crease inside for big yardage.
Blocking the back. Offense. Number two. 10-yard penalty. Second down.
Terrence Pride calling for the illegal block in the back. Anthony Jones has a Super Bowl ring. Spent 3 years at Morehouse before he came to A&M in 2002 as the head coach. The SWAC coach of the year in 2006. The only time that Alabama A&M has won the SWAC championship. And again, with a win today, they keep their own destiny in their hands. Alabama State with a win clinches a berth in the SWAC title game. Third and 13. They'll keep it on the ground with Terrell Beatty. Shot from behind by Nigel Carr, who's playing his first game of the season. The transfer from Florida State University was just cleared after an academic issue. Carr was jacked up to play in this game. He's been practicing with the team. He was very emotional when he found out that he was cleared academically to play in this game. Leland Baker, who will split duties at some point with Nigel Carr in that linebacker spot. Those two have been studs.
He's one of my impact transfers there. The coaching staff, they were just in awe over his tenacity and his intensity he's been bringing on the practice field. They want to see how that translates here on game day.
Wilson punts it away. Good stand by Alabama State defensively after a turnover. And it's played by Keewon Riley. Just to prevent any ball from going deeper into Alabama State territory. So the Hornets have it with 3:10 to go. Visit our Facebook page, facebook.com/ESPNU, and want to ask you, what's your favorite HBCU classic? Let us know what you think. Go to facebook.com/ESPNU.
And each classic has it brings a, its own flavor to the game. You know, you go to the Bayou Classic, that's obviously a big one with Grambling and Southern every year. Florida Classic, which is huge, Bethune-Cookman, Florida A&M. Circle City Classic is one that used to be the end-all, be-all. That was the only classic that really brought in teams, different teams every season.
Late flag thrown as Devin Dominguez ran it on first down.
Holding. Offense. I'm a 66. 10-yard penalty. First down.
It's Jerron Bush getting called for the holding penalty. A guy who was a defensive tackle 3 weeks ago and has converted to the offensive line.
And that lets you know how thin that the Hornets have been on the offensive right. line. And if there's been a little chink in their armor, it's been the offensive line play has been spotty at times, and they don't have a tremendous amount of depth.
They've allowed over 30 sacks this season, the most allowed by a SWAC team. Dominguez. Landon Jones reaching again to make that catch, getting close to the original original line of scrimmage. Landon Jones, the catch radius has been very wide for Jones today, bailing out Dominguez.
And he's one of those receivers that has good hands. You can tell those that struggle to catch balls and those that have the ability to snatch the ball out of the air and catch the good old-fashioned way. He's got those NFL-type hands.
Second and 11. Five-man rush for the Bulldogs. Nick Andrews gets separation. First down catch out to the 35-yard line. 18-yard pickup for Andrews. Derek Harris finally swung him down.
Good job by Dominguez standing tall in the pocket, knowing he's going to get hit. You're going to see, once again, Corey Hart's going to get there just a step late. And Andrews beating his man immediately off the line of scrimmage. Easy target to throw to.
Luther Snipe was the defender who got beaten originally by Andrews as a timeout is called. Nick Andrews has been solid today, as he always has been in his career. Five catches on the day for Andrews, who ranks first all-time in touchdowns. He got his 26th in the game against Prairie View A&M. He broke the receptions record a couple of weeks ago against those Panthers, and he's still closing in on Reggie Barlow's all-time reception yard record, trailing about just 29 yards.
Pretty sure he'll get that record there. Doesn't need that much more yardage there. But what a good player he's turned out to be. And the charge that Coach Barlow made to Nick Andrews when he first got the job at Alabama State is, I want you to break my records.
Right.
And Nick Andrews has responded and has had an exceptional career down at Montgomery.
And a 3.4 GPA to go along with it as well. An outstanding character on this team. His brother John is a wide receiver as well. And he moves the sticks on that catch. First and 10. For Dominguez and the Hornets. Dominguez got past the line of scrimmage, so he'll have to take another hit. He'll get 2 yards, and it's a hard-earned two as he gets knocked down by Markeith Clyatt and Philip Harvey.
And that's what we've seen develop here. We said that if the receiver's not open right away, he does not have enough time in the pocket to make his progression. So good job by the Alabama A&M defense continuing to confuse the Hornet offense.
Dominguez off his back foot throws it away. Third and 8. And Corey Hart was right in Dominguez's face. And A&M's only rushing 4-3-4 guys at a time now.
And schematically, they're just picking them apart right now. And until Dominguez feels comfortable in the pocket, then he's not going to be an accurate passer. What you have to do is you've got to protect him first. You're not going to have a quarterback that's comfortable in the pocket if he's always getting hit every time he drops back to throw the football.
Dominguez. Only 5 incompletions, over 100 yards passing for Dominguez today. Most of that has been to Nick Andrews. Another 3-man rush for the Bulldogs. A dangerous pass, but a flag thrown. Andrews in the middle of the field might have been interfered with. Joshua Uday, who's getting the start today for an injured Chris Irvin, a fine freshman safety who was injured against Texas Southern and is out for the season.
15-yard penalty. First down.
We'll get flagged for the pass interference, and Alabama State will move the football again.
And one of the few times that Dominguez has actually had a nice pocket, and he stood tall in there and delivered what would have been a big play had there not been a penalty.
So Dominguez works his way into A&M territory. 3 timeouts to work with and a minute 33 remaining. Boy, a touchdown would be huge. For Alabama State, don't forget that A&M will get the football to start the second half.
Once teams cross midfield, the Bulldogs like to bring pressure. Let's see if Coach Towns applies the blitz.
Hart, standing position, coming off the edge. Dominguez steps up. McWilliams couldn't hang on. Another flag is thrown. Clarence Morris was defending. We'll see about the flag. McWilliams nearly hauled it in, but could not hang on.
Man, that was a late flag coming in there for that pass interference call, if that's what the call's going to be.
Pass interference. Defense. Number 29. 15-yard penalty. First down.
It is Morris, the senior from Prattville.
You can hear the crowd's reaction to that PI. I think the whole stadium thought that was very late. The ball was in the air being bobbled. And then they called that. It looked like pretty good coverage.
First down, Alabama State.
Well, Alabama State takes over at the 32-yard line. The beneficiary of a couple of penalties against the Bulldogs. And Devin Dominguez trying to lead a touchdown drive for the first time today. Bulldogs only had 10 men on the field. Landon Jones, incomplete. He had to go high for that one. Second and 10. Just part of the celebrity panel that's here at the Magic City Classic today. Lisa Ray McCoy, famous actress, is the ambassador this season.
Look, she gave us the wave.
There it is, yep.
Is that the beauty pageant wave right there?
Dominguez fires. And Derek Harris knocked that ball away. And again, by our count, I think the Bulldogs only had 10 men on the field the last couple of plays.
And they've got an opportunity to get one-on-one coverage with Landon Jones there. They just have not been able to convert. If you're a quarterback, that's where you want to go. And Jones has been winning that matchup, but Dominguez has not been able to find him on a consistent basis. See, regardless of what the pressure is, this matchup right here at the top, that's the one that they've been able to take advantage of. Landon Jones one-on-one with the cornerback.
And the Bulldogs do have 11 now defensively. Dominguez rolling to the left, running out of time. And he'll pick up a couple of yards on third and 10. Melvin Payne was bringing the heat. That'll bring up fourth down with a minute 15 to go. Reggie Barlow's team, a real inability to move the football today.
They've struggled, and that's something they're going to have to go and make some halftime adjustments from their offensive staff there. Bronski Towns and the Bulldogs have been hitting the Hornets often and hitting the quarterback. And they've already knocked out one quarterback. Dominguez, the backup, he's getting hit as well.
3 for 5 between 40 and 49 yards Wednesday this year. This one from 46. Gives Alabama State points 4, 5, and 6. The two field goals for the Hornets here in this second quarter with a minute 9 to go. So Wenzig has done his job. Now the Hornet defense needs to make a stand. This is some time for Alabama A&M. 69 seconds. Remember, they get the football to start the second half. So if the Bulldogs can do something offensively here, that will really put Alabama State into a big hole going into the second half.
And that's what they've got to do. And, you know, the special teams, that's been one of the weaknesses of Alabama A&M thus far this evening. So see if they can give them a little boost and possibly add on. Because slowly but surely, Alabama State, although they haven't played well at all, they're creeping back in this football game, only down by 11 points. That's an easy margin to overcome if you get things rolling.
One of the great shows, the Magic City Classic, and one of the big reasons you come to one of these games, the band's getting set for halftime. Terrence Pride, this time, will take a knee, unlike last time where he bobbled it in the end zone. So from the 20-yard line, a timeout and a minute 9 to work with for an Alabama A&M team that has forced 3 turnovers today against a team that came into this ball game leading the country in turnover margin.
A little dose of their own medicine for Alabama State. You know, this is the part of the game where you start to really feel it. Like, there's a buzz in this audience right now. I mean, halftime is so big at all black college games, but when you've got this type of crowd and the bands leave the bleachers and they start to accumulate on the sidelines, everybody's on the edge of their seat. The people that are outside eating, they're coming in just so they can check out the halftime here at the Magic City Classic.
One of the main differences with this game, unlike other games, has been there's a lot riding on the game itself. Lacey up the middle, maybe a game of two. clock continues to move with a minute to go here in this first half. Again, Alabama State with a win will clinch a berth in the SWAC title game. Alabama A&M at 4-1 in the SWAC East. They can maintain its own destiny in its hands with a victory. And A&M with 56 seconds to go. We'll see the clock stop with a timeout. And Reggie Barlow, I don't think Reggie Barlow called that timeout. We'll see how the schedule shakes up for these two teams the rest of the way. A&M has Alcorn on the road, Jackson State, Prairie View, A&M, very good defensive team. Alabama State, just two more games remaining, Pine Bluff and Southern.
And if Alabama A&M wins this football game today, I mean, taking on Alcorn at Alcorn, not an easy road trip, not an easy place to play. Jackson State, I mean, they're ranked in the top 25 in FCS football, and Prairie View is a good football team as well. They're winning. They're currently in the lead on the Western Division of the SWAC. So Alabama State can clinch a berth in the SWAC Championship with the victory here. A&M will still control their own destiny, but by no means do they have an easy road to make it back here to Birmingham.
And again, Jackson State, due to academic issues, is ineligible for the SWAC Championship. Mason under center, giving it to Lacey. And third down for Alabama A&M, and with 51 seconds to go, Alabama State will take a timeout to stop the clock.
You know, and going back to that Jackson State being ineligible for the SWAC Championship, just to clarify a couple things, you know, one, are they eligible for FCS playoffs even though they can't go to the SWAC Championship? The answer is no.
Right.
And that's because the disqualification for Jackson State not being eligible for the SWAC Championship is an NCAA mandate. So the NCAA said that Jackson State is having issues with APR. They got hit with APR sanctions, so that would eliminate them from the postseason. Now, the good thing that Jackson State has done is Coach Comegy has really got that team focused, saying, well, we can't make it to postseason play. Let's go out here, win all the games on our schedule if we can, and maybe win the National Black College Championship, which is, you know, the mythical thing, which is in the hands of the voters.
The pollsters, right.
The pollsters. So that's something that they're focused on, what they're trying to do. And you see Jackson State ranked right there at the number two seat, right behind Alabama State.
Third and eight. Lacey won't have enough for the first down. He'll bring it to the 25. 44 seconds to go. And Alabama State hoping to get the football back again. Alabama State and Jackson State both 6-1. A&M playing very well. This is the SBN poll entering action today.
You know, it's ironic. I think Alabama A&M should be a top five team. You know, you've got them at number six, but they're clearly one of the best teams. You know, their losses have been very close losses. And they're one there. And Jackson State, Casey Terrio, I mean, probably the best quarterback in the country at this level right now. If you've got a quarterback, you can win championships. And I'd have to say, at number 10, South Carolina State being 4-4, that's probably the surprise. That's been the surprise. They were projected to win the MEAC conference. Some people had them ranked in the top 25 overall. For them to be at 4-4, that's probably been the biggest surprise of this black college football season.
They got knocked out last week by FAMU. Big upset win for FAMU. Based on that series, South Carolina State had won 8 in a row. And then South Carolina State did bounce back for a win over an unnamed team that I will not mention because of who is standing next to me.
Did they beat the Bison today?
They did beat the Bison today. 4th and 6, Alabama State used a timeout. 47 seconds to go. Wilson will punt it away. Riley get his hands on it at the 36. Gets a good block and gets some extra yardage into A&M territory to the 44. And no timeouts, 36 seconds to go, a 19-yard return after a 40-yard punt.
And that was great usage of the timeouts by Reggie Barlow during that drive. Once A&M came out and established they were going to run the ball and be content with an 11-point lead at halftime, he used all three of his timeouts in order to force them to punt the ball, let them kick it to one of your best players, probably your best player, Keywon Riley, see if he can get you a big return. And if they can get another 3 points going into the half, wow, they've done a good job at clawing back into this football game.
Dominguez, design roll. And a nice job of getting it to Nick Andrews, a pickup of 5 yards. And they do say he was able to get out of bounds and stop the clock at 30 seconds. So very good use of the sidelines.
Good job by Dominguez, and of Andrews, not trying to get that extra yard so often that young receivers do make. Get what you can, get out of bounds, stop the clock.
A half dozen catches for Andrews today. The pickup of the pressure. John Andrews makes the grab, but he could not stay inbound, so the clock is moving.
It'll stop as they set the change, which is good.
It is a first down, right?
So now you want to get up there, and as soon as that ball, the referee sets that football, you want to be able to kill that clock right away.
Dominguez will move under center, and this is very good use with about 2 minutes to go. The timeout usage from Alabama State, the use of the sidelines, the quick movement here from the Hornets. This is a very good drive end of this first half.
And good recognition by Dominguez of Alabama A&M playing very soft coverage on the outside. Nobody even close. This is an easy throw. Look how far away the defender is. He's 10 yards back when the ball's leaving the quarterback's hand. Good recognition, picking up the first down and killing the clock. And now, with the good strong kicker that they've got, they're in field goal range.
Wenzig has already hit from 48 today. This would be about a 43 yarder or so. Easily in Wenzig's range. Dominguez flushed out, has time, and a great throw again to Landon Jones to the sideline. Stops the clock with a dozen seconds to go. They're going to rule it incomplete. They're going to say he was out of bounds when he caught the ball.
Was he really? You can tell when Landon Jones makes the catch. Nothing gets on his body. He catches everything with his hands. And
you saw the bobble right at the end of the play.
That's Fred Kice, the offensive coordinator for Alabama State. Seems as if he's made a couple of adjustments prior to halftime and got the Hornets with an opportunity to really get back in this contest after being pretty thoroughly outplayed, I believe.
You see Luther Snipe, who's mixing in with Joshua Uday for the injured Chris Irvin at the safety spot. He's down, the freshman from Tuscaloosa.
And
And we talk about Fred Kice in his first season. He replaced Melvin Spears, who went back to his alma mater at Alcorn State. He's a black college veteran, stops at Hampton, Tennessee State, Southern, Alabama A&M as well, Morgan State. And he and Reggie Barlow very close. Reggie Barlow actually got recommended by Kevin Gilbride, the offensive coordinator of the New York Giants, about Fred Kice. And Fred Kice, the guy you want. And Kice has really mixed things up this year. Reggie Barlow says that Fred Kice is bringing the total package to this offense.
And to Barlow's credit, he said, having Kice here allows me to be a head football coach, meaning I can do the things away from football that I need to do as a head football coach. He completely trusts Kice with the offense and allows him to run the show. And what a great job of recognizing what an offensive coordinator is supposed to do by Reggie Barlow.
Well, Snipe from Tuskegee being helped off the field. And third down, clock is stopped, 12 seconds left in the half. Maybe one more opportunity here to take a shot into the end zone for Alabama State before they go for a field goal.
Look at that. They got the wave going here. You know, they've had the slow motion wave, then they had the fast wave. They've got everything you want in a college football game atmosphere here in Legion Field.
And it's still a close one. Big third down at the end of this first half. Be an opportunity for a field goal for Wenzig, who has accounted for all the scoring today. John Andrews was the nearest target for Dominguez. Wenzig, we'll see what he's done today. This one right around that same range, 47 yarder, around 47, 43, they'll mark it. Wenzig has it blocked. A monster play by the Alabama A&M defense at the end of this first half. Preston Nelson up at the line.
Yeah, I know they brought good pressure from the edge. Was he able to get there and lay out his body? And a good job of leaping in the air. Had several A&M defenders trying to participate in that block. And low trajectory kick by Wenzig keeps the Hornets off the scoreboard. Missed opportunity for three more points.
the fourth time that a Wenzig field goal kick has been blocked this season. And if you were to ask Anthony Jones what an ideal situation would be at the end of this first half, he'd probably tell you, take the ball away, keep the ball, and outscore him. It's an 11-point lead for Anthony Jones and the Alabama A&M Bulldogs at halftime of the 70th annual Magic City Classic. It's the end of the first half. Let's get you to the SportsCenter U studio for the State Farm Halftime Report after these messages. News College Football Primetime at the 70th annual Magic City Classic. And how about this? The 22nd ranked team in the country down by 11 at halftime. Alongside Jay Walker, Adam Amin on hand. Very interesting first half. Alabama A&M, again, a team that really came in with a chip on its shoulder, I think. They haven't won a SWAC title since 2006. They want to put themselves into position to keep their own destiny in their hands. Alabama State, on the other hand, can clinch a berth in the SWAC title game with a win today, but they didn't play up to their expectations. They coughed the ball up three times in that first half.
Yeah, where was that sense of urgency? You know, right. You got an opportunity to seal your fate, and they didn't take advantage of it. Got thoroughly outplayed in the first quarter. Very fortunate to only be down by 11 points at halftime. It could have been more.
Yeah, and let's take a look at how Alabama A&M got to a better state in that first half. It's brought to you by State Farm. They really relied on their bruising back, Kadarius Lacy.
Yeah, heavy dose of Kadarius Lacy on the very first drive they had. This is what he was able to do. He rushed for over 100 yards in the first half alone with the power running game. They lined it up. He knocked them down, bruising style, getting into the end zone. Alabama A&M got to a better state with the running of Kadarius Lacy.
Along with the rest of that Bulldog front, Lacy 102 yards rushing in that first half. Let's take a look at our first half stats from the opening 30 minutes. And again, the turnover is the big factor. Alabama State leads the nation in turnover margin coming into this game. All of a sudden, they're minus three in that category.
Yeah, dose of their own medicine being given to them by the Alabama A&M Bulldogs. Consider the fact that A&M is winning this football contest with 12 yards passing. But conversely, Alabama State, 0 yards rushing on the ground.
And meanwhile, Lacy has really put it to Alabama State so far in this ballgame. Big rushing effort for a guy who averages less than 100 yards rushing per game. And still one of the top three rushers in the SWAC this season, but already well over that average in half number one. Bobby Wenzig accounted for the only scoring in that first half for Alabama State. Terrence Pride had a rushing touchdown on the wide receiver spot in the first half. And Alabama A&M, which blocked a field goal of Wenzig at the end of the first half, preventing any more Hornet points, starts with a football on its own 20-yard line here in the second half.
It'll be interesting to see what the adjustments made for Alabama A&M. Do you continue to just pound the football using a heavy dose of Kadarius Lacy, or at some point do you decide to try and get your quarterback on track in Mason and see if he can maybe take advantage of some opportunities in the passing game?
Deontay Mason, only 6 passes in the first half.
And that stat right there tells it all. They're not asking him to do a lot. He's completed 5 of the passes that he's attempted of the 6, but for only 12 yards, that lets you know they don't plan on emphasizing the vertical passing game, which is probably smart considering that's the strength of the Alabama State defense is in their secondary.
Mason rolling to the right. He'll get some yardage close to the sticks as he steps out near the 30. Mason, who did rush it 4 times in the first half, will have the first down yardage on the first play here this second half. Mason, again, not a very accurate quarterback, not a downfield quarterback, though. They worked the screen game. We saw them actually win their last game on a screen pass that Mason throws. So they like the short yarded stuff, and they like to pound it with Lacy. And sure enough, not deviating from the game plan, Anthony Jones didn't have to deviate from his game plan in the first half.
Going to it right away, running the football, which is what Coach Jones wants to do initially. And Mason just being a game manager at this point. So far, being successful managing his team to a 17-6 lead.
Lacy on first down, good yardage picked up, 8 yards. And you got to look at Keewon Riley, who is really one of the most explosive defensive players in the SWAC. You see what he's done. Six interceptions. He's top five in the country, but they've taken him out of the game, essentially. And you made a great point. Not a lot of vertical passing. We saw that Prairie View A&M game a couple of weeks back. They tried some more vertical stuff. Riley had a pick in that game. A couple of passes that could have been intercepted, but the Bulldogs, you're right, they've taken Riley out of the equation.
They have, and Riley, what makes him so special is he's got great range. He plays that center field position for the Hornets right in the middle of the defense, and they like to let him roam free and just read the quarterback's eyes. He's a great read and react safety.
Brian Nelson out of the backfield, his first catch of the season, and he gets out to the 46-yard line. A first down for the Bulldogs. Nelson, the sophomore from Bessemer, Alabama.
Well, we talked about Keewon Riley being a good free safety player. He doesn't want any of Nelson right now. Watch Riley. That's him number coming over, number 26. Watch this attempt at the tackle. he didn't want any of the big fella.
And Nelson has one carry on the season. Now he has one catch. Nelson is on the sideline. Terrell Beatty is into the ball game in the backfield. Lacey is on the sideline as well. So both the running back and the fullback, both are on the sidelines right now. So Beatty coming out of the backfield. Catch is made by Kenneth Harris, the tight end. Just his fifth catch of the season, 19 yards for Kenneth Harris, the junior, and a transfer from North Carolina.
Yeah, great job by Harris after the contact. Puts in a nice little stiff arm there on the defender. Get off me. Follow that up with a spin move. Very athletic tight end in Kenneth Harris.
Donovan Maslin got thrown down on that stiff arm. Anthony Jones appreciates it, I'm sure. Big, powerful guy. Spent 5 years in the National Football League. Hornets showing a little bit of pressure. And a timeout will be called. As a flag is thrown, looks like a false start penalty perhaps against the Bulldogs.
Start. Offense, number 67, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Left tackle Jamal Johnson-Webb, the junior from Atlanta. Reggie Barlow and his team, 6-0 in SWAC play. No Alabama State team has ever gone undefeated or untied in SWAC conference play. There's Beatty. Get to the 35-yard line after a pickup of five. Meanwhile, Anthony Jones has had the better of this duel since Barlow's been the coach, and obviously Jones has been a head coach twice as long as Barlow, but 7-2 here at the Magic City Classic.
And this is one of those job security type games. You can have a bad year coaching your team and your win-loss record not be that good, but do you win the Magic City Classic, you keep the big alumni happy, gives you an opportunity to hold on to your job a little bit longer. Coach Jones, last year, kind of was on the hot seat a little bit. I think he's rebounded very well this year.
Get a look at Lacey back into the game. He says right ankle taped up. A room for Mason along the left as he rolls out. Saeed Lee touched him first, and he gets close to the first down marker after pickup of 8 yards. So Mason running it.
And this is a good job by the tight end, Bobby Goolsby, number 88 in white. Coming off of the bootleg, once he realizes the quarterback is going to run right there, watch him turn around and block. That's good recognition, realizing quarterback's got the edge, sealing it on the outside on Leland Baker. Good job. Good job by Bobby Goolsby with that block. So often, they'll sit there and wait for the football, then the guy runs up and hits the quarterback.
Brings up a third and manageable, and Alabama A&M has struggled on third down today. Push Mason forward for a first down on third and two. And they'll move the sticks.
So we see what the adjustment has been for Alabama A&M. They're going to start getting Mason on the edge, doing the bootlegs, giving him simple reads. Either throw it to a guy that's wide open or run with your legs. Alabama State has to keep Mason in the pocket, not fall for the play action fake.
Play faking with Lacey out of the backfield. He's got Nelson in front of him. Good hole for Lacey. Barrels it to the 10-yard line before Riley got him down. Pick up of 13 yards.
This is good old-fashioned smash-mouth football. Two tight ends in the game, so you have a balanced offensive front. One wide receiver, fullback in the backfield. Follow the fullback, and you'll find a collision. Wow! right there in the middle of your screen. Brian Nelson once again mixing it up. And Kadarius Lacy continuing to run through arm tackles.
242-pound Nelson, 230-pound Lacy. First down from the 10. Good cut by Lacy. He'll get to the 6.
They're just lining them up, trying to push them off the line of scrimmage. And you'll see Lacy, we talked about the size, but watch the recognition of the hole. Oh, cut up on the inside to pick up some positive yardage. We said he's a great north-south runner.
Right.
Showing he's got the ability to run east-west just a little bit. Call him a northeast runner. How about that?
Well, Lacy, 102 yards in the first half. And this has been the difference in this game so far. Both teams are very good defensively in the red zone. But Alabama A&M has taken advantage of its red zone chances. 2nd and 6 from just outside the 6. A read to Lacy, a pickup of 1. 3rd down from the 5.
Wouldn't be surprised here to see Alabama A&M go to that play action again. Lacy's done a good job of giving them the running threat. Look for them to try and get Mason outside on the edge on the perimeter. Give him a run pass option.
How about this methodical drive early in this second half? 11th play of the drive coming, and over 6 minutes taken off the clock. Anthony Jones joked around yesterday, said, if I get a 7-0 lead, I might milk it all the way down. And he's got an 11-point lead and a chance for more. Mason has blocking from his backs. Only get about a yard. That'll bring up 4th down. A chip shot field goal attempt perhaps coming for Alabama A&M.
That's a good job by Mason, not forcing something that's not there. Rolling out, wide receiver wasn't wide open. Hold on to the football. Don't take points off the board. You're in field goal chip shot range, as you mentioned, Adam. And Mason just held on to the ball, got what he could get, and then went down.
It's about an extra point right now. He's had to angle it in. Pride the holder. That lead is extended to 2 full scores. 7 minutes taken off the clock and a 14-point Bulldog lead.
Okay.
Bad drug now.
What's up, bringing the flavor brought to you by McDonald's. They know how they do it here in Birmingham, Alabama, the 70th Magic City Classic, and Alabama A&M a very long drive to start this second half. 7 minutes plus taken off the clock and added 3 more points for a 14-point advantage.
And they've thoroughly put the pressure on Alabama State's offensive unit. They've got to respond. When a team's going to have long, methodical drives like that, you've got to match them with a quick strike or another long drive of your own. But you've got to get some points on the board.
McKibben and Cyrus to return. So this Cyrus has some space. And out to the 28-yard line. Let's take a look at our Lexus playbook brought to you by Lexus.
Talk about a one-man wrecking crew. Corey Hart was all over the field for Alabama A&M. They moved him from a linebacker position to a defensive end to some nose guard. Whatever position they put him at, he found a way to get to the quarterback and dominate the Hornet offensive line in the first half. Corey Hart, one-man wrecking crew. He, our Lexus playbook.
Devin Dominguez, the backup, still in this ballgame. Remember, Greg Jenkins, the starter, out early in this game. False start is going to be whistled here.
False start, offense, number 62, 5-yard penalty, first down.
It's right guard David Haight. So this will push it back 5 yards, and you see what Corey Hart has done today. Bronski Towns, the defensive coordinator for Alabama A&M, has been there for 33 years now, by the way. They're saying that they wanted to widen it out a little bit on the front line and contain the running of Jenkins and the running of Dominguez, because he's a pretty good running quarterback as well. As he rolls to the right. Finds McGee Leftwich, his tight end. That's the first catch of the season for the sophomore from Georgia. It's a pickup of 17 yards for Leftwich, and good efficient pass from Dominguez, who again is a good running quarterback. They wanted to contain that running game. They've seemed to do a good job of it, at least in the first half they did.
Yeah, they've had Dominguez really running for his life as opposed to being an effective runner. He's been able to elude a couple of sack opportunities, but he is not the home run threat in the running game that starting quarterback Greg Jenkins is.
Nick Andrews, outstanding target. A first down catch. He'll pick up 11 yards. Andrews will likely go down as the greatest receiver in Alabama State history. That's saying something. He has his seventh catch of the day.
And Andrews really benefited from the bye week. He was really banged up, playing probably around 75%. Now they say not quite 100%, but closer to 95%.
First down run for Dominguez. He brings it out to the 36. That's the running attack for Dominguez. Rico Porch tripped him up after 14 yards picked up.
Good job by Alabama State moving the football, but this is where they've struggled before. Right when they cross midfield, get around the 35-yard line, A&M brings pressure, and they figure out a way to disrupt them.
Pressure came again. Dominguez throws it away, second and 10. Let's take a look at where I'm from. It's brought to you by the United States Marine Corps, and this is the Alabama State roster. Most of it home cooking, but they've done a nice job of recruiting. Reggie Barlow's a great recruiter, and he really gets guys to buy into his system.
And having played at Jacksonville in the NFL for the Jaguars, you can see why Barlow's able to go down to Florida and get 17 players. Pretty good football being played down there in the state of Florida.
Catch is made by Andrews. He'll get the run. It's going to break an Alabama State record. Nick Andrews is now the all-time leading receiver in yardage in Alabama State history. He busts it open for 24 yards to break his head coach's mark.
And that's the way you want to break a record, on a highlight film, highlight reel style run right there. Two defenders there. They tried to hit him, knock him out of bounds, showing great balance and the ability to adjust and turn it upfield and pick up big yardage.
125 yards receiving on the day. It's his eighth career 100-yard receiving game. And he breaks Reggie Barlow's all-time Alabama State record for reception yardage. More importantly, he sets up the Hornets. Tim Clark inside the five. Finally gets dragged down by Vernon Marshall. A run of 18 yards, and Tim Clark and the Hornets trying to hurry things up and punch in a touchdown for the first time today.
They're trying to set it up. They want to call the same play. Tim Clark thinks run the same play over again, but not so fast. Good job by Barlow. Coach Kite's taking their time, saying, no, let's see what the defense is going to give us, and then we'll call a play at the line of scrimmage, which has been working for us.
This is the first red zone chance of the day for the Hornets, who are the best red zone offensive team in the SWAC. 86% in the red zone. And Devin Dominguez, with five on the play clock, will call for a timeout. Didn't like the look. Working out of that hurry up. In the no huddle, Reggie Barlow appreciates the decision made. And there is Nick Andrews, eight catches on the day. He's the all-time leading receiver in touchdowns, in receptions. And now he surpasses his head coach, the great Reggie Barlow, for career receiving yards in Alabama State history. A class kid, Reggie Barlow, absolutely very, I imagine, very happy that Nick Andrews just did what he did.
Yeah, we talk about this is how you want to break a record. Watch the balance here. Bam! In between two Bulldog defenders, stays on his feet, accelerates. Good job by Nick Andrews, and congratulations, young man. Job well done.
It's back-to-back games. He's broken some kind of record. Reggie Barlow told Nick Andrews, if you don't break my records, you've underachieved, because you're literally that good. He said that to us too, that if he did, I would have felt bad if Nick Andrews didn't break my records, because he deserves it. He's that good. And at only 5'9", he may be a little bit undersized to most guys' standards. Great hands, though, for a guy at 5'9", and he makes all the tough catches, and he really runs well.
So often we get caught up by size and statistics and everything. And Nick Andrews, just a guy that you say he's a football player.
Inside the red zone, Clark. Nice job defensively by Alabama A&M. Markeith Clyatt just got a piece of Clark before he could dive to the end zone. Third and one coming up. You could still pick up a yard and have four more chances. Alabama State, best red zone offensive team in the SWAC. You saw that other graphic about Alabama A&M. They lead the country in red zone defense.
86%, that's a phenomenal job of getting it done. And if they can pick up this first down right now, right, pretty good chance of increasing that percentage.
Very short, so it will be third and one, third and inches, really. Corey Hart is off the field right now.
Yeah, we haven't seen him play yet in the second half, and gotta wonder if he's okay, if he's healthy. He had such a tremendous impact on this football game in the first half. To not see him play in the second half is rather shocking.
They're gonna re-measure this, I believe. Getting one more look at it, just to make sure. I think Reggie Barlow is upset because this kind of kills a little bit of the momentum that the Hornets had. Alabama State only one third down conversion. Dominguez trying to push the pile. The forward progress should probably be enough for the first down.
That was real close. I mean, he only needed a matter of inches, but it looked like no surge at all. And they did a good job of standing up Dominguez as soon as he took that snap. As a quarterback on a QB sneak, you want to stay as low as you can. Dominguez got stood straight up and then pushed backwards.
And it is a first down run, enough for Dominguez, and four chances from the one.
Yeah, this is that first down run. Look, you see he's standing straight up. Nothing good can happen on a quarterback sneak. When you stand up, you got to stay low. Very fortunate that he was granted those couple of inches necessary to get the first down.
Hornets still without a touchdown today. They've got four opportunities from the 1 yard line. Tim Clark is the back. Dominguez carrying it himself. He'll have enough for the touchdown.
We knew the pressure was on the Alabama State offense. They responded to the call. A&M came out, scored on their first possession in the second half. Alabama State does the same.
Two long drives for both teams. And Devin Dominguez engineers the first touchdown series of the day for Alabama State. As poor as they looked in the first half, with the three turnovers, the inability to move the football, with 4:40 to go here in this third quarter, Alabama State is within 7 points. A 3-minute drive for number three. He punches it home from a yard out. When we come back, one of the great defensive Bulldogs of all time, Robert Mathis, will talk to us.
Welcome to the team. Here's your signing bonus.
Better deposit that before you get hurt.
Oh, State Farm Bank's pocket agent. It lets you deposit checks right from your phone.
Devin Dominguez did not start this game, but he finishes a touchdown drive from a yard out to bring Alabama State within seven. One of the great defensive players in Alabama A&M history set an NCAA Division I AA record, 20 sacks his senior season in 2002, and now one of the great defensive linemen in all of the NFL, the Indianapolis Colts. Robert Mathis joins us. Robert, thanks for taking the time. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me on.
Well, you got to appreciate what your Bulldogs are doing right now defensively. They did just give up a touchdown, but for the most part of the day, they've held Alabama State in check. That's going to make you feel good, right?
Oh, yeah, make me feel great. You always want to get a win over your arch rival, so go Bulldogs.
Robert, you've had some tremendous success on the college level, but how special was it for you to play in this football game, the Magic City Classic?
Oh, it was real special. Knowing that that's one of the biggest games in the whole state of Alabama, and everybody just looks forward to that game in the Magic City, being at Birmingham. So it's just a great time all around for both schools.
Robert, one of the things that I know is that Bronski Towns has a real special relationship with you in your life. Talk about legendary defensive coordinator and your relationship with Bronski Coach Towns.
He looks at me like I'm a son. I look at him like a father figure, and he just wants nothing but the best for me, and gives me the best advice that he can, and just always has my best interest at heart. And that's how he does a lot of, just not with myself, but a lot of the guys that come in. He's a homegrown guy, and so he's that guy that you always look up to.
Robert Mathis joining us from the Indianapolis Colts, the three-time Pro Bowl selection and Super Bowl champion. Robert, also wanted to give you a congratulations. You actually graduated from Alabama A&M, went back to school and got your degree in summer of 2010. That also has to take maybe a weight off your shoulders and make you feel good that you've got a degree from this university that gave you the opportunity to play football.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if a lot of people know, but yeah, Alabama A&M was the only school that gave me a chance. So I'll always be in debt to Alabama A&M. Just thankful to go back and finish what I started, because, you know, I made that promise to my mom that with all the success on the football field, that you want to take care of things in the classroom. So I was thankful to be able to do that.
Well, Robert, you're a tremendous student athlete now. You're in the NFL, the Indianapolis Colts. You all are struggling a little bit yet to get a win. What's it like in the locker room, and how are you guys trying to keep this together?
We're still upbeat. It don't stop. We're still, you know, being professionals about our craft. And so the guys, we're still working hard, playing hard, and just trying to get over the hump. And so I feel that we're going to be able to do it.
Well, Robert Mathis, the Alabama A&M Bulldogs, seeing his team with a 7-point lead right now. Robert, thanks so much for the time. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
One of the great Bulldogs, at 20-sack season in 2002. Absolutely ridiculous. Deontay Mason deep inside of his own territory, 15-yard run, and this will add 15 more on the Riley horse collar tackle.
You see, it'll come right at the end of the run there. You leave your feet and bring them down. That's a typical horse collar tackle, very dangerous. You can't do that there.
So an Alabama State penalty hurts the Hornets big time right now here in the third. Only two offensive drives in this half so far. This is the second touch for Alabama A&M. They had a 7-minute drive to start this second half, ending in a field goal. Alabama State gets its first touchdown of the day with a 3-minute drive. Long drives for both teams. 72 yards for Alabama State. It was a 75-yard A&M drive to start this half. A 7-point Bulldog lead. Mason. His tight end could not hold on. It was Harris that dropped the ball. Second down, and we'll take a look at Robert Mathis's fine career. Three-time Pro Bowler, one Super Bowl 41 with the Colts against the Bears in 06.
And you talk about having 20 sacks. I mean, you got some people that are lucky to get 20 tackles in a season. He
got some teams sacks. Don't get 20 sacks in a season.
He was definitely getting it done. It seemed like every time the light came on, he played his best football. That was the mark of a true champion there, and rewarded with the Super Bowl victory there. And, you know, Dwight Freeney and Robert Mathis, that's the 1-2 punch. That's considered the number one pass rusher in the NFL.
I really thank Robert Mathis for taking out the time today as Kadarius Lacy carries it for a gain of one.
And did you hear what he said? He said Alabama A&M was the only school that offered
Isn't
him a scholarship. And you've got all these, you know, ratings, how they rate all the players all over the country. How'd he slip through the cracks?
Right.
I mean, wow.
I think of a guy like Tavares Jackson from Alabama State, who joined us earlier today as well. He had to transfer out because he didn't get a shot at Arkansas. And he turned into an NFL quarterback starting for the Seahawks right now. And we've been very lucky today to be joined by both Tavares and Robert. 3rd and 9 for Alabama A&M. They're 2 for 10 on third down today. Mason takes a deep shot.
Oh, look at that grab.
Guess who? Keewon Riley. For the 27th consecutive game, Alabama State has a takeaway.
We talked about Keewon Riley earlier. We said he does a great job of playing center field. Gonna read the quarterback's eyes, make a break on the ball. How about this for style points? One hand. He went up and got that with one hand. athleticism, great range, Keewon Riley.
Holding, defense, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, first down.
The holding penalty will push it back a little bit, but Keewon Riley has his 15th career interception. We mentioned 27 consecutive games now with a turnover, 29 takeaways this season to lead the nation. Alabama State, they got away from the game plan, A&M. That's the first real shot we've seen down the field. The vertical passing game, that's where the Hornets thrive on defense.
And we can see why. Now I'm pretty sure when A&M gets the ball back, they'll be very close to the vest and won't go downfield very often for reasons just like that. What a great opportunity for Alabama State to get right back in this contest and possibly tie if they can get a long drive.
McKibben gets the fake. Dominguez to the left. 5-yard pickup for Dominguez on first down. Anthony Jones also said it, though. If we're going to turn the ball over, it's probably better that we turn it over, not giving Alabama State a short field to work with offensively.
Yeah, deep down the field, where you give your defense an opportunity to get a stop and get the ball right back for you. And you see Corey Hart back in the football game.
A one-handed grab by Nick Andrews. A 5-yard pickup. And enough for a first down. About Andrews? So Riley and Andrews, one-hand grabs in the last couple of plays.
You just get the feeling if Alabama A&M were to move up their defensive backs and not allow Alabama State to throw those short 5-yard passes, they would get a hit on the quarterback and possibly force a fumble. But every time Alabama State drops back to throw, Dominguez is not holding on to the ball very long. They're just using the short passing game.
Dominguez can throw downfield. He's averaged over 100 yards passing in his games this season. He keeps it again. A solid run before he's taken down by Vernon Marshall. That brings up 2nd and 6. A special Halloween edition of the Palmer and Pollock Show on Monday. Find out what tricks the boys have up their sleeves. Breaking down LSU, Alabama coming up next week. College football lives here every day on ESPNU.
Yeah, they're going to be in costume, too, if I'm correct. I believe they were asking the fans on the social media world how should they dress for Halloween.
Overthrown from McKibben on 2nd down. That'll bring up 3rd down for Alabama State. Reggie Barlow was actually asked earlier this week, the fact that Alabama is off this week, they've got a bye week this week, does that maybe turn more attention to the Magic City Classic? And he actually responded pretty well. He said, you know what, even when I was playing, all my buddies that played at Alabama, they were still watching out for my game in the Magic City Classic. That's how big, that's how, what kind of magnitude this game has. And a lot of magnitude on a 3rd and 7 for Alabama State after a turnover. Dominguez could not find Henry. Overthrow him. And 4th down for Alabama State, a punt.
And one of the reasons why this game is so special, I mean, geographically, I don't know if you could find a better center medium. You know,
sure.
Huntsville is 1 hour and 10 minutes away.
Yep.
Montgomery's 1 hour and 15 minutes away. This is the city right in between, the big city down here, the state of Alabama. Plenty of fans and people. It just comes together so nicely.
Wenzig punts it away. Short kick. We get a friendly bounce. The head out about the 38-yard line. 35-yard punt from Wenzig. 1 minute to go in the 3rd. Bulldogs have the ball. Magic City, Birmingham, Alabama. They call it the Pittsburgh of the South. Steel and iron production really gave Birmingham its boost when it was formed as a city in the 1800s. And the largest city in Alabama, the site for the 70th time, the Magic City Classic. Alabama A&M with a 7-point lead. 1 minute to go in the 3rd. Kadarius Lacy gets to the edge. Pick up about 5. Pick up on 1st down for Lacy.
Coming off of the turnover, the interception thrown by Mason the last time the Alabama A&M had the ball. Get prepared to see a heavy dose of Kadarius Lacy right now, and they don't hide it. I mean, no bones about it. They bring in the fullback. They go to that I formation. Here it's coming. Can you stop it?
Alabama State, a takeaway on A&M's last drive, but couldn't do anything with it. Nelson, the fullback. Mason, kind of an off-balance throw, and it's third and short.
And that play was doomed from the start. Mason tried to do a play-action pass to nobody. There was nobody in the backfield for him to do it. Take a look at this. The backs are going to split. There's nobody to fake to. You're not going to draw on any linebackers with that. And just got rid of the ball.
And Harris was the closest man. Mason, just 11 passes on the day. And Anthony Jones had Mason throw a downfield pass and had it picked off. Last touch.
On this third and short, take a look at Brian Nelson. See what the fullback does. They'll probably use him as a lead blocker.
And Kadarius Lacy will easily pick up the first down.
Watch this. He's going to run around the block. So you're going to see the outside linebacker come in the backfield, but does not want to have any part of this collision here. So he's ready to lower that shoulder. Oh, good job by the cornerback coming in there from the outside, using his speed to get around that block. But that's the, you don't mind if that happens if you're the fullback, because that means you cleared the hole and there was a gap for Lacy to run through.
And that was that very dangerous Florida State transfer, Nigel Carr, who's been coming in on third downs today. Inside of Alabama State territory. Lacy is upended by Slater, and that'll take us to the end of the third. Pick up of 3 yards for Lacy. Big bruiser doing it big today for Alabama A&M, and a 7-point lead for the Bulldogs as we head to the fourth. For the 70th time, the Magic City Classic here in Birmingham, Alabama. A big one with big swag implications.
Wednesday night volleyball is on ESPNU. Two of the Big 12's best battle as Iowa State takes on Oklahoma. First service Wednesday at 8 on ESPNU.
Are you Team Palmer or Team Pollock?
Log on and you can hit us up at Twitter and you can tell us which ones you think are the best.
Jesse Palmer and David
quarter in Birmingham, Alabama. Alabama State, the number one black college team in the country, trailing by 7. Let's take a look at our game summary so far through 3 quarters. And it was all Alabama A&M really in the first half. A little trickery for the Bulldogs.
They started using misdirection to go along with the power running game between Lacy, and then you saw Pride there get it on the end. But this was the play of the game right there. Big hit in the hole. Lacy keeps his balance, rumbles into the end zone, and then Alabama State got down in the red zone and they converted with the quarterback sneak by Devin Dominguez.
Again, Dominguez in there as the backup after Greg Jenkins was injured earlier in this game. Lacy has been the big bruising back, and Dominguez has done enough to keep his team in this ball game as we head to the fourth. 2nd and 7 for A&M inside of Alabama State territory. Lacy getting the handoff. Good play by Leland Baker. Bring up 3rd down after a 3-yard pickup. Alabama State, only 1 loss overall this season. It came against an FBS team in Eastern Michigan. This is only the 2nd time all year that the Hornets have trailed going into the fourth.
And we talked about that Eastern Michigan game. They actually thought they could have beat them, which would have been right, huge for that program. You can tell by the score, they lost by a touchdown, but played very competitively against the boys from Ypsilanti.
A&M just 25% on 3rd down today. They'll give it to Lacy to try to pick it up. And sure enough, a 5-yard gain to move the chains. Boy, how big would this be for Alabama A&M? They still hold their own destiny in their hands, a 4-1 record. Alabama State could have clinched, and still can, obviously, with a win today. They can clinch a berth in the SWAC title game against Jackson State, with APR issues, is ineligible for the SWAC title game. This is how much was riding on this game. It's always a big party. It's always going to be sold out. But for the first time in a couple of years, there are a lot of stakes on this game. Read option. Mason tried to stiff arm and get away from Carr, but Nigel Carr swings him down after a pickup of 3 yards. The experts, 1 and 7 Eastern on Tuesdays, ESPNU. The home for the passionate college football fans. My man Jay Walker calls it barbershop talk about football. Gotta love it. Make sure you tune in. Great panel coming up this week as well. Hosted by Anish Shroff, and Matt Millen joins the crew this week as well on The Experts, twice on Tuesdays, ESPNU.
I get real excited having the coaches on there. I'm a former player, but when you have a coach and you can understand it from their perspective, really sheds a light on a lot of issues.
Second and seven. It's Lacy reached out at the last second. Brandon Slater brought him down, but Lacy was down by contact. 3-yard pickup again. They're really relying heavily on Kadarius Lacy, over 150 yards rushing today.
And because they're controlling the line of scrimmage, he's able to gain momentum as he's going to the line of scrimmage. So even when the hole's not there, because he's got low pad level and he's got that momentum going, he's able to pick up 2 or 3 yards at a time. How do you combat that? If you're the defensive line for Alabama State, you've got to get underneath the shoulder pads of those Alabama A&M defenders to try and clog up the hole.
Third and three, and a big one for the defense of Alabama State. Mason will get the first down, and he'll get into the red zone. A flag thrown at the end of the play. Pending that, it's a 14-yard pickup for Mason on third and three.
Good job of just pulling the ball out. Once the defensive end goes down and commits, he pulls that ball out of there. But they called the holding there on Johnson Webb, the left tackle. That could have been a close one there, because you saw the defensive lineman clearly go in. He took an inside angle there. Carlton Jones, he got bailed out.
Second holding call on Johnson Webb today.
See, take a look at this. You're going to see Carlton Jones on the end. He goes all the way in. He's in. He's out of the play. Quarterback is already outside of the pocket. He got bailed out for taking a poor angle.
Pushes it back. Third down and about 13 to go. That ball is in the air, and it will hit the deck, fourth down. That could have been a pick six for Leland Baker and the Hornets.
Had he had the ability to hold on to this one, if you're Mason, the quarterback, you've got to see this. You see the pressure there by Carlton Jones, but if you're Mason, you've got to see behind the running back, because he's got his back turned to you. He does it. He gets rid of the ball. It's popped up. And, oh, missed opportunity there by Jakari Wilcox.
Now Wilcoxon and Baker both got their hands on it. There's a little screen for Lacy, if you want to call it that. Fourth and 13, and a punt coming. Chance Wilson. High and short. And down near the 20-yard line after a 20-yard punt. Good kick from Chance Wilson. So Alabama State down by 7. We'll take one more trip around the parking lots here in Birmingham with Jay Walker when you come back.
If you're having girl problems, I feel bad for you, son. I got 99 problems, but if you ain't one, hit me. 99 problems, but
if you ain't one. Hall of Famer John Stallworth, alumnus of
Alabama A&M, the Fighting Bulldogs.
What do you think about this tailgating environment?
I think this is fantastic. There's nothing like this anywhere in the world. If you're not here, you should be here.
You should be here. How you like my microphone?
Tally-ho! I got a surprise for you. Where else can you go to a tailgate and find hand-rolled cigars? I'm telling you, folks, this place is magical. All right, we've got good food, great people, tremendous atmosphere, cigars for the road. I can't eat another thing. That's a wrap from your boy, Jay Walker, here at the Magic City Classic.
Jay's stomach has already made a decision. Nothing has been decided in the Magic City Classic inside of the stadium just yet. It's been a good one so far. A 7-point game. Devin Dominguez takes a shot and could not connect with Andrews, who had gained separation. Willie Fuller got to Devin Dominguez while he was throwing that ball.
Continuing the trend of getting pressure on the quarterback. Even when Dominguez gets rid of the football, he's still getting hit, getting up off the turf time and time again.
Alabama State trailing by 7. Reggie Barlow's team hunting for a comeback right now. Dominguez keeps it, gets swallowed up. Vernon Marshall came in on the blitz. It's a loss of 3 yards.
The Achilles heels for Alabama State has been that offensive line. Poor pass protection. They give up the most sacks in the SWAC conference. Dominguez tries to call his own number. Once he does that, a swarm of Bulldog defenders there to make another tackle behind the line of scrimmage.
Alabama State has given up more sacks than anybody else in the SWAC. Alabama A&M second in the SWAC defensively in sacks. Three down linemen on 3rd and 12. Four-man rush, a shovel pass for Clark. A first down for Clark out to the 40. Big conversion on 3rd and 12. The senior from St. Louis moves the chains.
What a great call. You've got an aggressive defensive line that's trying to hit your quarterback. Well, let them think they're going to get another hit. And then give them the old okey-doke, the shovel pass, lead guard out there. Good play selection by the Hornets.
Big conversion for Clark, who made a start today. Usually has been a second or third running back in the rotation, but he's worked himself into a starter. And he'll get another handoff and a good burst. Where he's wrapped up by Jeremy Isabel. Gain of 6.
And Corey Hart doesn't seem to be the same player he was in the first half. They're still blocking him the same scheme, but that sense of urgency seems to have left. He's reacting a lot more rather than trying to create havoc.
A flag thrown before the snap.
False start. Offense number 13. 5 yard penalty. Second down.
John Andrews, the wide receiver, whistled for a false start. But I think you're right about Hart. Remember, he sat out a series to start the second half as well. And we're wondering if maybe something was up with Hart.
In that first half, every time the ball was snapped, he was like shot out of a cannon once he figured out where he was going to line up. Now, haven't seen that explosion. He's kind of been lackadaisical, not really exploding. And can't just say they figured him out. The opportunities are still there.
Dominguez on 2nd and 8. Solid decision from Dominguez. Nothing much really there. Brings up a 3rd and 8.
This is that time where Alabama State needs to come up with their best offensive play. You want to try and score. If they're going to win this football game, they're going to need to score twice. With 10 minutes to go, kind of starting to get a sense of urgency, saying you got to make something happen. Identify where Hart is right there. That's why Dominguez is going up to the line of scrimmage trying to make a change. Now he comes all the way back across the formation.
Five-man rush. Dominguez needs 8. He'll get it and more. Devin Dominguez into the open field. Huge extra point block. Chartavius Keith prevents a tie. How about this turn? It's the second block kick of the day for the Bulldogs. But things have taken an interesting turn. The longest run of the season by an Alabama State Hornet. It's a 59-yard scamper by Devin Dominguez. But with the Hornets an extra point away from tying this game, the Bulldogs with a clutch block. Still, Bulldogs in front with 10 to go.
Here's to the things that keep.
ESPNU College Football Primetime is presented to you by McDonald's. I'm loving it. Got to look at the largest cast iron statue in the world, the city symbol of the Magic City, the Vulcan statue. Entered in the 1904 World's Fair in St. Louis. Representing the steel and iron industry that made Birmingham a powerful force in the United States. And Devin Dominguez with a 59-yard touchdown run, but an extra point blocked by the Bulldogs, and still A&M is in front by a point. Terrence Pride from the 8-yard line. Pride down the sideline. Good effort by the kicker Wenzig after a 41-yard return from Terrence Pride.
What a return by Pride, and he almost kept his feet once he left and made the jump. But let's take a look at the long touchdown run by Devin Dominguez, and they're going to overload the line. Look at this right here. There's no bubble there. Dominguez has already slid the protection to his right. He takes off to the left. Nobody home. Becomes a foot race, and who says that Devin Dominguez doesn't have that home run hitting ability? I said it earlier. I take it back. Great job.
Statement rescinded. But again, that extra point block is huge. The Bulldogs blocked a field goal at the end of the first half, and here they block an extra point and have excellent field position after the return from Pride. 9:46 to go. Smith on the screen makes a move on Baker. Flag thrown on the play. Pick up of 7 yards.
Probably have wide receiver holding.
Offense, number one, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Gialonzo Milton with the holding call on the outside. But this is what Alabama A&M has done defensively against Alabama State. The mistakes from the Hornets, 3 turnovers and 2 block kicks.
And if you ask Coach Barlow, with all that happening to you, and you'll be in the fourth quarter with 9 minutes to go and you're only down by 1 point, he would take it. Alabama A&M has created the turnovers, but they have not been able to capitalize offensively, and that's why we've got a 1 point football game.
And don't forget, Alabama State has scored 19 of the last 22 points. This was a 17-0 game at 1 point. 2-yard pickup for Kadarius Lacy. Carlton Jones pushed him down. Lacy has been really the stud and has carried the biggest load for the Bulldogs today, over 150 yards rushing. But he looks a little bit winded right now, hands on hips. 32 carries might do that to you.
Yeah, he's earned it. You know, they've been riding him. He's been the big Bulldog here in this stadium. With a 1 point lead, not enough. They're going to need some more production out of Kadarius Lacy.
Career high is 178 yards. Did that against Grambling earlier this year. Second and 12. Now keep at it with Lacy. Still short of midfield. College basketball season tips off on ESPNU Sunday night. The One State, One Spirit Classic. Missouri and Missouri Southern. This is an exhibition game in Joplin, Missouri. An E5 tornado hit earlier this year in May. And a moment of silence will be recognized at 5:41 Central Time, the official time and touchdown. One State, One Spirit, presented by Leggett and Platt Inc. on ESPNU Sunday at 6:30 Eastern. I think the state of Alabama can also sympathize with the situation in Missouri earlier this year. Both states saw some great cities ravaged by tornado damage, and it's a great thing that Frank Haith and the Missouri Tigers are doing. On 3rd and 10, Lacy will be short out of the backfield. Markinley St. Fort with a big defensive play. Remember last week he had a vicious hit on Greg Thurman of Prairie View A&M. He comes up with a good stop to force a fourth down.
He's one of those highlight film defenders, knows how to make textbook tackles and can really lay some wood when he gets there. Momentum is just gone from this Alabama A&M offense. They are running on 3 flat tires, and it looks like the fourth tire is ready to blow out as well. Alabama State, for the first time in this contest, really has momentum in the stadium crowd behind them. They seem to be in control of this football game, even though they're still trailing in the football game.
A&M's longest punt return this year is only 25 yards. Kewan Riley from the 9 can't get away from Vernon Marshall. 36-yard punt. Alabama State down by a point takes over with under 7 minutes to go with a spot in the championship game on the line right now for the Hornets. A win today clinches a berth in the SWAC title game. Meanwhile, A&M trying to keep its own destiny in its hands.
Yeah, A&M's got to win this football game if they want to get there. Jackson State and Alabama A&M will play in 2 weeks, so that could have some implications if A&M is able to win this football game. But if not, Alabama State will be in clear control. Good job there by Heisman Northern, too. I saw that Prairie View A&M team first weekend of the season. They did not look good, but he's done a good job in rebounding, having them in contention to represent the West in the SWAC championship.
Devin Dominguez, after the 59-yard touchdown run, takes over very late. Decision on the read to Clark, and it's a loss of three. Second and 13 coming up. You look at Tim Tillman, who is in the backfield. Junior from Augusta, Georgia. Clock moving at 6:25. Alabama State trailed 17-0 at one point in this game. Dominguez has Clark if he wants him, but can't get away from the pressure again. Melvin Payne. Another loss on the fifth sack of the day. This is the last drive we saw from Alabama State. This was the Dominguez score.
Well, this has been the key play in this football game thus far. Dominguez showing the ability and recognition of the defense and the athleticism to run it all the way down into the end zone. That spark got them right back into this football game, but they did not convert on the point after attempt. That's why they trail by one.
And don't forget, that was on a third down play. Dominguez did a good job on third down that last drive, but now needs the 29. Vernon Marshall jarred that one loose. John Andrews could not hold on, and fourth down with less than 5.5 to go. A punt coming for the Hornets, and the Bulldogs come up again defensively.
Yeah, they called the wide receiver screen in anticipation of some form of blitz coming. One of the few times in this contest, Alabama A&M went with the pure cover two with the cornerbacks playing soft coverage, delivered a big blow. They had the perfect defense call for that play. And Alabama State was fortunate that ball wasn't ruled a fumble.
How about this boomer from Wenzel? Smith all the way back to his 28-yard line. But is the coverage there for him? And Wenzel, the kicker, drags Smith out. A 66-yard boomer after a big kick from Wenzel. Smith brings it back 22. 5:18 left. Bulldogs have the ball and a one-point lead. Magic City Classic coming down to the wire with 5:12 to go. A&M has the football, good field position, and a one-point lead. Special edition of the Palmer and Pollock Show, the spooky Reggie Barlow's team has scored 19 of the last 22 points in this game, but still trails. Best field position since the first quarter for the Bulldogs. Deontay Mason makes it a little bit better. Inside the 40 to the 38-yard line, of pickup of about 9.5 yards.
This play took me back a couple decades. This is a good old-fashioned option right here, the dive option. Put it in the belly, the fullback, pull it. Decide either to keep it or pitch it. Great decision by Deontay Mason of holding on to the football, picking up the first down.
They give him enough for the first down, and the clock moves again after they reset the chains. Under 5 minutes to go. Alabama State again only has two timeouts defensively if it does start to come down to the wire a little bit. Two tight ends and an I formation. Lacy. Kadarius Lacy continues to pound the football a half dozen more yards before Donovan Maslin brings him down.
Great job by the left side of that offensive line, and Jamal Johnson-Webb and Bryant Ross really controlling that line of scrimmage and having a nice running lane for Lacy to run.
On a first down today, A&M has averaged 7 yards per play.
Wow. That's getting it done, and you can tell right now they're in no rush right now to get plays called. And I know Coach Edwards like to call this hammer time right now. 4 minute offense with a 1 point lead. You need to pick up some first downs. See if they can get the job done.
Lacy Needed only the 29-yard line. Might have enough for a first down, depending on the spot. Nearly 40 carries on the day for Lacy. It will be a third and one. And they have put a big load on Kadarius Lacy today.
And rarely do you see that in college football today, because you see so many situational backs. But Lacy's a guy that stays in the football game, whether it's a run or a pass. Good, solid football player.
Big third and one right now. Will they go to Lacy again? Mason will keep it. Sneaking, trying to find the first down. And should have enough to move the chains. With 3:07 to go.
I think with one more first down, your Coach Barlow, you got to start thinking about, when do I use the timeouts?
Been a frustrating day for Reggie Barlow and the Hornets. All those first half mistakes, they were right in this game. Still looking at that blocked extra point, the blocked field goal, the three turnovers. Kadarius Lacy has been the big bruising back. May have just picked up a new career high in rushing yardage as well. On his 36th carry of the day, a career high. Lacy picking up a good chunk.
Yeah, just power football. See him get the ball. He's looking downhill, looking for somebody to hit. Right now, you can tell, we talked about him being a little beat up. Well, that defensive secondary for Alabama State, they're looking a little timid coming to the hole as well. That'll happen when you're trying to bring down big bruising running backs in the fourth quarter.
178 yards. For Kadarius Lacy. Devin Dominguez hoping he gets one more chance. Lacy just sets a new career high on second and three. Picks up 5 more yards. And I think he's starting to feel it. And I think the Bulldogs are too.
Not quite. I think now, if you're Reggie Barlow, now you got to start using those timeouts. After this play, you've got to think we're going to call a timeout, but it all starts with getting a big defensive stand.
Hornets used their second timeout of the half. Minute 42 to go. Hornets have one timeout left. They have not lost a SWAC game this season.
Yeah, you're kind of questionable. Why do you let 22 seconds run off the clock before you decide to call that timeout? You don't have the luxury of having all three timeouts. You've got two. You know, you've got to make that decision right away. I thought the moment you got that first down is when you've got to step up and call that timeout, or wait till the next play, then call it. So if you're Alabama A&M right now, you are in a great position right now. You got to think that Alabama State is going to call a timeout after first down, and on second and third down, be curious to see if they decide to take a knee or not. Coach Barlow, that look, trying to figure out what can he do, and you got to give credit to this Hornet team. They clawed right back into this game, and if they fall just 1 point short, what a disheartening way to lose.
Hornets need stops. Bulldogs looking for first downs.
Protect the football.
Mason holds on to it. No gain. Second down. Nigel Carr got to him. And the Hornets, see if they use that final timeout, and they will. A minute 43 left. This is what was at stake coming into action today. Alabama State 6-0. A win would guarantee them a spot in the SWAC title game. Meanwhile, Alabama A&M still has a long way to go. They still got 3 more games in the SWAC after today, but they'd be in very good position to if they do win out the rest of the way to be in the SWAC title game.
They will. And that matchup versus Casey Terrio and the Jackson State Tigers is going to loom large for the Bulldogs. If they get this victory today, then they take on that Prairie View A&M squad, who we saw through the standings. They're number one in the West right now. So if they make it, they will have done it the good old-fashioned way. They will have earned it.
And again, this would give A&M the tiebreaker over Alabama State, and that's why they would hold their own destiny in their hands if they can win today and win out the rest of the way. And they have two home games to try to do it as well. Anthony Jones's team trying to win a SWAC title for the first time since 06. Second and 11, no more Hornet timeouts. They load up the line. Lazy still gets positive yardage anyway. Third down coming up. They can get this down to about a minute or so. This is going to be very close for Alabama State.
And the key is protect the football.
Right.
Time and time again, we've seen it happen. This is where you've got to know it's not worth it if you're Alabama A&M to get that extra yard. It's almost if you're at the point where you go down with the first contact.
Don't forget, Alabama State has not lost a SWAC game since last year. They've won 9 consecutive games. Devin Dominguez worked his tail off to get that touchdown. But the extra point blocked. A&M still with the lead, 3rd and 7. Lacy, not enough for the first down. The clock at about 47, 48 or so, and Lacy went down. And they can get this down to about 7 seconds before they have to even snap the football.
And I'm pretty sure Coach Jones is going to call a timeout right when that clock winds down to 1 to talk about what they're going to do. And if you're going to go for the field goal, then you want to talk to your field goal attempt team to make sure they shore up their protection. The timeout being signaled for by Coach Anthony Jones.
Handful of Bulldog wins this year have come down to the wire, including their last victory against Texas Southern. The game-winning drive in the fourth.
They can prove victorious. What a great job of responding to this coach by Anthony Jones. And we talk about a guy we said was a little bit on the hot seat last year coming into this season. Lost his first two contests. Starts off 0-2. What does he do? Fires up his team, gets them to respond by winning 5 consecutive games and 6 seconds away from making it 6 consecutive games and having a fantastic season.
Anthony Jones, 7-2 in the Magic City Classic. A&M has won 5 out of the last 6. 4th and 5, they'll line it up with Mason. Just trying to push the pile. The clock's going to stop. The clock is going to run out. Alabama A&M snaps Alabama State's 9-game SWAC win streak.
It was a classic in the Magic City Classic, 1-point victory and 6 straight wins for the Bulldogs.
A 6-game win streak, the 3rd time under Anthony Jones, but the Bulldogs have rattled off a half dozen consecutive wins. And for the 8th time in 10 tries, Anthony Jones has won a Magic City Classic. We welcome you to the Lexus HBCU post-game report. Anthony Jones, another victory here in Birmingham. They have rallied around Anthony Jones, haven't they?
They have, and the team has responded very well to him.
Alongside Jay Walker, Adam Amin on hand. It truly was a classic this year. One-point game, and that's the 26th time in 75 meetings between these two teams that it's been decided by 6 points or less. They really go down to the wire. Anthony Jones said it yesterday, discipline. We need to be good defensively. We can't let mistakes beat us. And frankly, they didn't let mistakes beat them at all today.
Yeah, they turned the tide. We thought that Alabama State was going to come in here and do like they've done all season long, create turnovers and capitalize. Well, this time it was the Alabama A&M defense creating the three turnovers, and then they made some tremendous special teams play. None more important than that point after attempt being blocked to secure the one-point victory.
Let's take a look at our highlights from this ball game. First half, a little trickeration, as they like to say. Bulldogs get a Terrence Pride touchdown.
Razzle-dazzle, they were able to get the ball in the end zone, and then there was heavy Kadarius Lacy. And look at this great run right here. I don't know if you'll find a better one there. Good job of getting the ball in the end zone. They started having their way with the Hornets.
Meanwhile, in the third quarter, remember at one point it was a 17-0 A&M lead. Devin Dominguez punching it in from a yard out, trying to get his team right back into it. Dominguez had a massive play in this ball game. On a third down, needed 8 yards. He went 59, the longest run this year by a Hornet. And everybody was thinking, the Hornets got the Bulldogs right where they want them. Until this, Chartavius Keefe, the extra point blocked, and that turned out to be the play of the game, because that forced Alabama State into a tough spot defensively. How about Kadarius Lacy, a career-high 189 yards rushing today?
He was hungry, and they fed him, the ball over and over again. He was a fantastic football player. Good job by Devin Dominguez coming in as a backup role and almost leading his team to victory.
Greg Jenkins injured earlier in the ball game, and Dominguez came in to try to lead the comeback charge. This is what the standings look like now. Alabama State 6-1, their 9-game SWAC win streak dating back to last year is snapped, and A&M holds its own destiny in its hands. 3 more SWAC games remaining for Alabama A&M. Once again, our final score in the Magic City Classic lived up to its billing. 20-19, Alabama A&M with a win. Coming up next, we'll send you back to the studio for SportsCenter U. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For our entire ESPN production crew, Jay Walker as well, Adam Amin saying good night from the Magic City, Birmingham, Alabama. Now let's get you to SportsCenter U.